We will come back into session. We actually started the meeting at 6 o'clock. We had an executive session. We will start off with announcements. I actually have one announcement. The Greene County Health Department, Combined Health District, has a survey out, an online survey for the update of the community health assessment. There is a very long email or a very long web address. We do have it posted on our website.
I put it on Facebook. John, I don't know.
It will be put on our website, but it's also on Facebook. So the Greene County Combined Health District is asking for citizens to go in and take this health survey. So we wanted to make sure citizens were aware of that.
And yeah, just to confirm, it is on, I saw it today. It's now on the homepage of YSO.com. Okay, yeah, I have a few things. Thanks for mentioning that. I wanted to mention that the CBE survey, which is available to be taken by SurveyMonkey, or we have various boxes with cards to write your answers at Tom's, the Emporium, the Senior Center, the library, and downstairs at the Bryan Center. That survey is going to technically close on February 22nd, so tomorrow. That being said, I mean, all comments will continue to be appreciated, but we are trying to gear up for the first community conversation, which is scheduled for March 2nd. That will start at 7 o'clock in rooms A and B. We will have a hard stop at 8:30. It will be facilitated by our village mediators to get as much input as we can. And I do want to mention, we won't probably talk about it today, but this follow-up conversation was scheduled for April 27th, but we realized there's a conflict with an important event at the Coretta Scott King Center. So we will be coming up with a different date. And then two quick things. Make sure to make it to the McKinney Chili Cook-Off this Saturday. It's always great food and a great time. Starts at 4 o'clock. And Antioch School's annual gala with comedy and silent auction and live auction is going to be on March 4th. So that's the Saturday following. And then Chris being here reminded me that I thought I'd give a heads up about the Active Transportation Commission, which meets monthly. Next meeting will be March 13th, and that's going to be at 3:30 in the library moving forward.
Thank you. Any other announcements? Moving on to the consent agenda, it includes the minutes of the February 6th regular meeting, the minutes of the February 10th special meeting, which was an executive session, and the financials for January of 2017. Can I get a motion, please?
I have a question, a simple question, I think, about the Mary financials.
Could I just ask Melissa
sure.
a question? I don't understand why the electric operating funds and the solid waste operating funds in the balance sheet, I think, were negative numbers.
There are probably some negative numbers that are on there just because the electric and the solid waste both have contracts and purchase orders that are opened at the very beginning of the year that go ahead and encumber all of our costs for our power. Which is the majority of the electric fund, and solid waste, it's the same thing. We go ahead and open up a purchase order for the whole year to cover all of the costs of that. And sometimes with the rollover from the previous year, it can cause some strange things to happen, so I can take a look into that, at least with the solid waste fund. But I know that there was some carryover encumbrances from the previous year that I still need to clean up. That I was working with Johnny some on the electric fund, but there's no concerns.
Thanks. Motion.
So moved.
Second. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Next is a review of the agenda, and we do have a full agenda, and I think council would like to be able to get out of the room at 10 or before even would be nice. So I did add some times to this. I added 15. I planned on 15 minutes for the public hearings and legislation, 10 minutes for citizens' concerns. We are actually, I would like to ask that we add a special report, Krista McGough from Tecumseh Land Trust, to talk about the property on Dayton Yellow Springs Road that will be auctioned in March. I have allotted 10 minutes for that, 50 minutes for old business, 10 minutes for new business, and kind of 5 minutes for the staff reports, and 30 minutes for us to do our commission reports. So that gets us out, I think, a little bit before, about quarter till. So hopefully that'll work, quarter to 10. Anything else? Oh, I also was going to suggest that we add the active transportation proposal that was in the packet into new business.
Yep.
Any other additions or changes? Okay. Go ahead. Did you?
I was looking for it, Chris. Did you need to get out at a particular time? Because I know you're talking about active transportation.
I'm getting it at 1:00.
Okay.
And I apologize for not putting swearing in on the agenda, but and that should have come sort of at the top. If you don't mind doing the swearing in, that's usually at the second meeting, and I neglected to put that on the agenda. We do have a person to be sworn in.
Oh, yes, we do have a swearing in. Mr. Johnson, would you?
Right.
Eric Johnson is here to do, to be... to be sworn in as a returning member of the Energy Board, and he is going to read his oath of office.
I solemnly swear or affirm that I will support the Constitution and will obey the laws of the United States and the State of Ohio, that I will in all respects observe the provisions of the Charter and ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, and faithfully discharge the duties of the Office of Energy Board Member.
Great. Thank you, Eric. Thanks for coming back and
yep. Thanks for your service.
For all your good work.
Yeah, thanks a lot.
Thank you. Sorry about that. Judy, he was sitting right in front of me. We've got that done. Brian, could you review the petitions and communications?
Yeah, so a good segue for the Energy Board is we did get a short analysis and report about cost savings that could add up to almost $30,000 by replacing current lighting with LED lighting systems. So I think that's something to look at as we talk more about our goals. Also, I realized that this was on the table, is there's a tire drop-off, and that is on Thursdays, March 23rd, April 20th, and May 25th from 9 to 11 a.m., and it looks like you get some money back for dropping off those tires.
And there is a little application that you have to fill out, and they're right outside my office.
Okay, great. Right outside the village manager's office?
That'll be here.
No, it's at Green County Solid Waste.
Yeah.
2145 Greenway Boulevard. It's over in Xenia, kind of parallel to 35, close to where the Kroger is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We can put that information on our website.
It's on there.
Okay, good. We received a letter from Laura Curlis, and the upshot of that letter was requesting that the village ask that all criminal charges be dismissed related to New Year's Eve. I imagine that we will be talking about that a little bit more under old business. And we got also from Greene County Public Health another notice about flu cases continue to be on the rise, and you can still get your flu shots if you need more information about that. And we already said we'd talk about the active transportation letter in new business.
Great, thank you. Moving on to public hearings and legislation, we have a lot of resolutions here. Judy, let's start reading them in by title only.
Okay, the first one is Resolution 2017-05, approving a 3-year employment contract with the Clerk of Council.
Okay, can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, so we kind of have a stop and a start on this one. Judy's contract was up in December. We did her reviews. We had great evaluations. Council evaluated her, and we also got information from the staff she works with and asked for citizen input, and it was all very positive. So we've asked her to stay. And we have our contract that will run for 3 years. So. Any comments or questions from citizens? Seeing and hearing none, I'll bring it back to the table. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Yes. Next, Judy.
This is Resolution 2017-06, approving the hiring of Brian Carlson as interim chief of police.
Okay, another good one. And I didn't know this hadn't been done, so this is good.
I swore him in and he's getting paid.
That's true, yeah. Can I get a motion on this?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. So any comments? I mean, Brian has been doing the job for, what is it, 3 weeks now? And we've been hearing only positive responses, and four, is that?
January 23rd.
This is as interim chief, so we will be talking about a process, but we're very happy to have Brian on board. Any other comments or questions?
Nope.
Comments or questions from citizens? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Next.
I was going to say, yes. We should probably clap for Brian.
And the next one is Resolution 2017-07, adjusting rates of pay for village employees.
Okay. Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. And at the last meeting, we were presented with some of the ranges in the region that had been researched by staff. Staff recommended a 2% across-the-board increase for all non-exempt village employees, and that is what the increase is that is before us. Any discussion by council?
Nope.
Any comments or questions from citizens? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Okay, the next one is Resolution 2017-08, standardizing employment contracts for the Village of Yellow Springs.
Can I get a motion on this one?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, this is something that we have contracts for our exempt employees, which are salaried employees, of which we have four: the chief of police, the village manager, the assistant village manager, and the clerk of council. And what we noticed in looking at these is that there were certain provisions within those contracts that were different from one employee to the other. It was creating some confusion for staff and some questions. So a decision was made to standardize some terms of those contracts. Certainly, there may be individual contract provisions for certain employees, but this was related to the number of hours and related to pay increases and such. So we just decided to standardize it so that there were no questions. Any other comments or questions from council? Comments or questions from citizens? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Judy?
Do you want this by title only, or do you want this one right here?
Let's do it by title only, and maybe we'll ask Mr. Heiss to say a few words.
All right. This is Resolution 2017-09, declaring 2017 the year of the trail in Yellow Springs, Ohio.
Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Third.
Okay, you get to choose there, Judy.
All of us.
Yeah, really. So this is very exciting for me. This is something that that the Greene County Commissioners passed about 2 weeks ago, and they are asking all of the jurisdictions within Greene County to pass. Mark Heiss is here, who is very involved in this, and I'd like him to say a few words about the Year of the Trail. Yeah, you can talk loud enough.
It's all right. I can speak loudly. My name is Mark Heiss. I live at 1120 Xenia Avenue, Yellow Springs, Ohio, and I'm the chairman for Trail Fest 2017, which is going to be held here in Yellow Springs, April 27th through 30th. We're bringing from 200 to 300 people from the Buckeye Trail Association here to celebrate the trails, not only here in Greene County, but across the state. The Buckeye Trail itself is the nation's largest circuit trail at 1,444 miles. And I have to say, when I lived here initially, I guess I've been here 10 years, I went to my first trail fest, and then I found out quite by surprise that the Buckeye Trail goes straight through the village of Yellow Springs. That was 4 years ago, and I made it my mission to bring Trail Fest here and to bring recognition to Yellow Springs for the work that we do to maintain the trails inside of Glen Helen, the bike trails. And it's a nice little pathway on the way to up to Dayton and then north from here. The trail is also part of the North Country Trail, which is a trail that runs all the way from East Coast to West Coast. So it's a really important thing, and the ironic thing is that the trail is just as much of an economic driver as it was when Yellow Springs was initially established as a village. So basically, I'd like to on behalf of Green County. One of the other things, and the reason this is 2017 is the year of the trail, is because we have in a very short period of time four very exciting things. One is annual, which is the Rails to Trails Conservancy runs an annual opening of the trail, which will be the first weekend of April, beyond Saturday. The second event will be Trail Fest, which averages the 27th through the 30th. And by the way, on the 27th, we're having a membership drive at the Little Art Theater, and we're going to be telling the story of Granny Gatewood, who is this wonderful 67-year-old woman who hiked the entire Appalachian Trail in nothing but keds and everything she needed wrapped up in a blanket wrapped around her. Absolutely an inspiring story. Immediately following that, on May 5th, is going to be, and also held in Greene County at Wright State University, the Miami Valley Cycling Summit. And lastly, in Dayton, that following Monday, we'll start with the International Trail Symposium, which will bring people and bring attention to the trails here in Greene County and in general Dayton area from all over the world. So I'd like to invite you to take part in any of those events. Karen, if you'd like me to, I'll provide links to those events so they can be placed on the website.
That's great.
And we look forward to it, and we're very pleased that Yellow Springs has joined Greene County in declaring this the year of the trail.
Great, thanks.
Thank you.
And we're actually it's being kicked off on April 1st with a trail cleanup day on Saturday. It's a service project by the Community Foundation and the boards that it serves. So there will be a trail cleanup day, I think probably starting at about noon after their annual meeting. So
yeah,
that'll be great.
Thank you for reminding me.
Yeah, very exciting. And I guess I just wanted to add for a couple things about the International Trail Symposium. First of all, if you are an Ohio resident, the enrollment or the registration fee has been discounted by $200, and you can just basically check the box that you're from Ohio. So that's kind of a great thing. They've never done that before. And we will also be having what's called a mobile workshop on the 7th, that Sunday afternoon, here in Yellow Springs. So we can show off our trail system, our piece of it, and also highlight the economic activities that relate to the trail. And I think that's going to be really well attended. But and I guess the last thing is, May is bike month in general, bike to work, bike to school. So there's a lot of stuff going on. And we are not only part of the nation's largest circuit trail, but also the nation's largest paved trail network is in the Miami Valley. So we've got a lot of things to tout.
Thanks, Brian. I guess we need to take a vote. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Next, Judy.
And shall I read this?
Yeah, read this in full.
Okay, this is Resolution 2017-10, recognizing the contribution of the Central Chapel AME Church to the celebration of Dr. Martin Luther King Day in the Village of Yellow Springs. Whereas Council for the Village of Yellow Springs recognizes the longstanding commitment that Central Chapel AME Church has made to the celebration of MLK Day in the Village by opening their doors to celebrants and providing a meal and friendship following the events. And whereas Village Council appreciates this longstanding effort to build community and understanding in Dr. King's name. And whereas Village Council understands that the event has now outgrown the ability of Central Chapel AME to continue to host the event, now therefore be it resolved that, Section 1, Council for the Village of Yellow Springs, on behalf of the entire community, expresses our appreciation to Central Chapel AME Church for their unselfish commitment for this day and our gratitude that this commitment has led to such a successful annual community event.
Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
I think it pretty much speaks for itself.
Yeah, and Karen, I've asked some of the members of Central Chapel AME Church to come tonight. Some of those have been very involved in getting the church ready, preparing the lunch, the soup lunches that we've had in the past. In the back is Dave Perry. Stand up. My two daughters, Leslie Mikasa, White Sims, Carolyn, Carolyn Walker Kimball in the back. We have Lynn Ayers and her daughter Vicki. We have our matriarch Betty Ford.
Everybody knows me.
and her daughter Lisa Ford. You know, and as the resolution reads, we hate to see it leave Central Chapel, but with any and everything, things get bigger and they grow. The community has grown from this, and I'm glad it has expanded. Mm-hmm. But again, want to thank Central Chapel.
Thank you.
But we were glad to do it.
Good, good. Thank you so much.
Where is it moving to?
It was at the theater.
Antioch
Theater.
Next, it might be at the high school next year.
Yeah, I feel like it's already outgrown, yeah. The Antioch Theater. It didn't take long for that to happen. Wow,
oh,
that's great.
Yeah.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Next, and let's read this in full also.
All right, this is Resolution 2017-11, recognizing that while observance of February as Black History Month has long been recognized by the United States, the Village of Yellow Springs recognizes the importance of building awareness and appreciation of Black history 365 days a year. Whereas Council for the Village of Yellow Springs recognizes the longstanding contributions of African Americans to the fabric of society in every aspect, and whereas Village Council recognizes that African Americans have made life better for the citizens of Yellow Springs through their work on the infrastructure of the village, donation of land for recreation, and participation in all forms of village government and educational leadership, and whereas in 1926, Carter G. Woodson created Negro History Week as essential to the physical and intellectual survival of the race as it exists within the broader society, and whereas expansion of Black History Week to Black History Month was first proposed by the leaders of the Black United Students at Kent State University in February 1969, and whereas Village Council shares a responsibility to oppose any act or effort that implies that African American history is not an integral part of American history, now therefore be it resolved that, Section 1, in the spirit of the evolution of thought regarding African American history in the United States, Village Council recognizes that Black history should be promoted as United States history and celebrated 365 days a year in Yellow Springs. Section 2, Council for the Village of Yellow Springs encourages businesses, organizations, and public and educational institutions to recognize that Black history is United States history and to provide education, access, and encouragement towards this effort.
Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
This is very nice.
Yeah, and so this one also, I think this is fitting, and it's, you know, we're the culmination of another Black History Month. We'll end in a couple of days. But as I sat back and reflected on, especially here in Yellow Springs, that the contribution that African Americans have made to the health and growth and prosperity here in Yellow Springs, that is time that we start looking at Black history as American history and celebrate it every day. Mm-hmm. Yes, we appreciate and are somewhat honored to have a month, but it should be a year, like everything else. And again, I've asked some additional members, along with Reverend Randolph, African Americans here in Yellow Springs, to come to the meeting tonight to to help receive both of these honors.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I was going to say, I appreciate the, you know, there's information in this resolution mm-hmm. that I did not know about, and I yes. really appreciate the resolution.
Well, with this, you will be able to learn a lot more.
Awesome.
Exactly. Yeah.
Thank you.
Very important.
Are you ready for the next one?
Yes.
Okay. This is Resolution 2017-12. This is strongly opposing the State of Ohio Governor's proposed 2017-2018 budget, which proposes centralized collection of net profit tax returns and other provisions related to the municipal income tax, which will cause a substantial loss of revenue needed to support the health, safety, welfare, and economic development efforts of Ohio municipalities.
Thank you. Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
So they're at it again, and I don't think it's ever going to stop. So this is related only to corporate taxes, but the proposal is that it goes that the state collects corporate municipal taxes and keep a percent for themselves and for the service they're providing us. And the other thing that's actually even more concerning is that there is some talk of sharing of income tax, more equitable sharing of income tax, even though each municipality levies and collects their own income tax. The Municipal League and all of the municipalities are going to be behind all of these things that come before us. Patty's in the loop and making sure we get all of these whenever, and we know about them, that we talk about them, write letters to our state reps and state senators, which would be Rick Perales and Bob Hackett. If we have an opportunity, talk to them at any time we have an opportunity. To remind them that this is local government money, this is local municipality government or money, and that it doesn't really need to go to the state for any reason. So,
and should we highlight a little bit about just the history of sort of the degradation of the local government fund?
Well, they cut it.
Right.
They cut the local government fund pretty significantly by about 30%. They eliminated estate tax, which was a pretty large portion of our, depending upon the year, it could be a pretty large portion of our revenue. There have been some other changes that didn't impact us quite as much as they did larger municipalities. But I would say that the state legislature actually doesn't believe in municipal income tax and are looking for ways to get rid of it. May or may not be a good idea in terms of how we fund of funding in general, but until they provide us with the ability to tax or to get revenue in some other way, income tax is half of our revenue stream. Is it more than half,
it's
Melissa?
More than half
of our revenue in the village, and it's paid by everyone who works in the village, whether they live in the village or not. And it's money that is used to support infrastructure, used to support our staff, used to support the services that we provide to those businesses as well as those employees of businesses. So it's why we feel it's so important.
And this is why you see municipalities across the state having to pass more levies or cut services. I mean, it's a travesty, really.
And it's also why municipalities are such good partners and think it's so important to bring jobs to their communities, because it's those jobs that bring the revenue from income tax. So I think we've talked that one to death. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Okay, now is the time in the agenda when we hear from citizens about items that are not on the agenda. We ask that you come up to the microphone-less podium and keep your comments to 3 minutes. State your name and keep your comments to 3 minutes. We have none? Oh, go ahead, Dawn.
Dawn Johnson, 234 North High Street.
There's a potential that the Arnovitz property, 267 acres, will sell at auction for development. This is several land parcels that are on the west.
It's on the agenda.
Is it?
Yes, we added it to the agenda, sorry. Sorry, yeah, I mean, no, yeah, would you mind? I mean, we're going to be talking about that. Krista's going to be here, yep. Okay, thanks. MJ?
My name is MJ Gentile, and I live at 122 West Davis Street. And I'm coming back to ask about divestment from U.S. Bank, from the village divesting. As I'm sure you know, a lot of citizens are divesting, and I'm sure you all remember apartheid in South Africa, and it was really divestment that caused that whole system to fall. And right now we're facing climate change, which threatens our very survival of life here on Earth. And it is a pain in the neck to move our money. I hear that from citizens. And I'm sure it's a pain in the neck for the village to move their money. I understand we have money in U.S. Bank in Huntington, and maybe it's a possibility to move it out of U.S. Bank and let them know. I'd suggest the credit union, but I'm not sure if there are issues with that. But it could really help spark a movement of courageous people. I mean, you could be the courageous ones at the forefront. Right now we have Davis, California, and Santa Monica, and Seattle that have all divested. Japan is looking at divesting. And we have Norway, the Bank of Norway pulled out. And I'd also suggest maybe while it's being investigated, I wrote a letter to the CEO from Village Council, and I can send an electronic copy if you want to alter it, but I could hand you a hard copy and you could check it out, just saying that the Village of Yellow Springs is investigating the possibility of divesting, and we want to stand in solidarity with the Standing Rock Sioux. So I'm just curious to hear where...
Wait, did you say you sent that to somebody from...
I didn't send it. I wrote one with the option of giving it to you all.
Okay.
You were trying to save us some work.
Yeah, to save the work of writing a letter yourselves. If you'd like to write your own letters, I'd encourage you to. But Marianne, I sent you an electronic copy. I'm happy to send it to the rest of you as well. But I'm just curious where things are with the possibility of divesting.
Melissa, is there anything you can report? It is a very difficult process. And
it is something that I'm gonna work with the treasurer and at least exploring. I know that we've talked in the past before all of this came up about just better opportunities for the village as a whole, but I can say that of the entire, all of the village's money, we've got 57% in Huntington and the state's Star Ohio program. So the other 43% of the village's money that we use for our daily transactional purposes are what's with U.S. Bank. So it's not the bulk of it, but there are other banks that it is spread out with. But I have been looking into that, though.
Is the credit union an option?
I haven't looked at that. I know that we'd talked about some other options in town, but we have not looked at the credit union specifically yet.
Yeah, generally, the structure of a credit union is a little bit different than it is for a bank as far as earning returns on your money, but we can certainly look at that.
So is the STAR account not at U.S. Bank?
No, that's separate? Through the state of Ohio.
Oh,
it's through the treasurer's office,
okay.
So it's an investment account.
Well, I'd like to say that if we were to move it, then I think it would be important that we look at the bank, the investments of whatever
right.
bank we move
yes.
it to.
Right.
We don't want to just...
Right.
And I would be in favor of having us draft a letter, maybe at least looking at the letter, and I'd be happy to help with that. And
that'd be good, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, and here on the letter, I guess... And also, just to reemphasize what Marianne said, if we can get any assistance about Huntington or West Banco or some of the other options, I mean, I think for the credit union, that's more us figuring out if that's something we can do as a government, you know, entity. But it would be helpful to have as much vetting of other potential banks as possible.
But I mean, I think that's good. I think we do need to do our own research. I do know that at least two of our large local foundations are looking into setting up socially responsible investment accounts, and they have the directors of both of those organizations have just talked about how difficult it is, because what is problematic for one person or not socially responsible for one person may be different from another. So to really understand what those restrictions are and what those values are can be very difficult to ascertain. But I think it's a great conversation to be had, and I appreciate you bringing it. And it is something immediately I talked to Melissa about, so she is working on it.
Well, and I've been wondering, too, if the first step is to let them know we're concerned and that we're considering it, rather than once you pull it, it's too late. It's kind of too late. So how is the most effective way to be putting pressure on them? I mean, we're only one small drop in the bucket, probably, but still, I still think it's important to maybe have a conversation. I have an account at U.S. Bank, and I spoke to one of the people at the one of the tellers, and said I was concerned, and was very nice, and said, "Do you want the phone number of the person, one of the people that you know you could talk to?" And so I think it's worth having a conversation. I mean, some people are just going to pull out, and I think that's fine too. But just to say, maybe there's a way to put pressure on step by step as we're trying to make this decision for our little piece of it.
And I really would like to encourage anything we could do with the credit union, because they really, sure. I've been working with Sandy on a number of different fronts, and they are really working to give back to the community in many ways, and being able to support them would absolutely help those efforts. So I would really, I'm not sure that it could be all of it, but if it's even a portion that we could work with them.
Well, and staff is going to the bank, and if it's not a local bank, then you're driving out of town potentially,
right.
Which, you know, so we should, if we could do it at, if the credit union was an option, that would be great, because
right.
It's right downtown. People can.
Do you want me to contact Sandy and let her know to get in touch with
me? I'm sure Melissa will take care of it.
I agree.
And would you like a hard copy?
Yeah, and then
sure.
And then but maybe we can just Marianne will let Marianne take the lead on this one and bring something to the next meeting.
Thanks, MJ.
Hi, Erin Rogers. I also live at 122 West Davis Street. I just want to second what MJ was talking about the movement of money out of U.S. Bank, but I specifically want to encourage, and it's encouraging to hear Karen say, specifically looking at U.S. Bank. It makes sense if U.S. Bank is looking at investing in Yellow Springs that our money also remains in Yellow Springs instead of going to a larger national chain, and I know that the credit union is trying to look at ways to locally invest our money, and I feel very strongly about that. It sounds like Karen does as well, and the council should, so if that's possible, and maybe setting a timeline so we can return to the issue in an appropriate amount of time. I know there's a lot going on right now, and this might not be number one on the agenda, but if it's possible to figure out a timeline and then communicate that, so we're not, you know, here saying the same thing every weekend.
Thanks, Erin.
Thank you.
Anyone else? Okay, we will move on to special reports, and I see that Krista McGaw just arrived. I don't know how many people have seen the thing that Krista's here to talk about is that there is a parcel of about 200, and a number of parcels of totaling about 267 acres west of town. That are owned by Matt Arnovitz that are going to be auctioned on March 15th. And we've got maps. Did you have something you were going to put up, Judy? So we'll just ask Krista to come up and review her thoughts and tell us a little bit about what's Tecumseh Land Trust has been thinking about this.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, good. We've got that. And I did send some information to council. I had shared some information with them.
Okay. All right, thank you. I really appreciate your chance to talk to council so quickly. We just found out about this at the end of last week. And Matt Arnovitz is not the only owner of Arnovitz property.
That's true.
We have talked to Matt over the years about the Jacoby Green Belt and the desire to try to protect the creek in particular. And have actually worked with him on some proposals that he's taken to the rest of the family. But they just really haven't seen fit to do that. And it is absolutely their right to auction off the land and to try to really get as much money as they're able to to distribute among the various family members that own this property together. Property is going to be sold off in an auction at the Hilton Garden Inn, I think it is.
On Pentagon Boulevard.
On March 16th, Thursday, March 16th. I really urge people to go to the Ohio Real Estate Auctions website. Ron Denny is going to be the auctioneer, and I've talked to him at some length about what our land trust does and about our intent to reach out to potential bidders on these different parcels to potentially work with them to put a conservation easement on them.
Where did you go?
After the fact, unfortunately, of their being purchased, because we just can't move, I don't think, that quickly. We do ask that the village consider participating with us in looking at funding possibilities for conservation easements on some of those parcels or all of those parcels. The type of auction that they're going to use is actually similar to the Whitehall Farm auction in 1999 with the set of 9 different parcels. The first round of bidding will allow bidders to bid on each parcel individually and determine a highest price in the room among the people who want track 1 and the highest price among people who want track 2. The next round then allows people to bid on multiple tracks together. And the combination that will be in place by the end of the evening for people who have 10% down payments with them will be the highest total of all the bids on those different parcels. There are some farm auctions where the highest price is on the total package. Farmers, especially with a lot of tillable acreage, farmers are thinking, I can just get this whole thing for a lower average cost per acre if I buy the whole thing. And that was the case with the Whitehall auction. Tecumseh Land Trust coming to the table with, at that point, $1.2 million because of a real outpouring of support from people in the village government itself, other local government units, neighbors, actually people across the country who had some kind of connection to this place. So that was a really unusual opportunity. We don't know exactly where this property falls in terms of people's interests in preserving green space around Yellow Springs. Part of it has been in the proposed Jacoby Greenbelt since it was first defined and adopted as a part of the village comprehensive land use plan in the 1970s. So it has continued to seem to be a very, very popular desire to try to protect that whole area. It is the least complete on the west side of Yellow Springs at this point in time. And I've got a few maps. The colored map has in dark green properties that are permanently preserved with conservation easements that Tecumseh Land Trust holds. The green little tree design property is John Bryan and Clifton Gorge, owned by the state. And there are definitely restrictions in terms of their ability to ever develop that land. That would be very difficult. And then, as best I could, we have in yellow the property that I understand to be historically a part of the designated green belt. The last map I have been able to find is from 2007. The Jacoby green belt was alluded to and discussed quite a bit in the 2010 planning process. Seemed to be very popular. It's there, it's alluded to, but exactly what the parameters of those properties are,
have not been recently looked at in really careful detail. What Tecumseh Land Trust has been doing consistently is to reach out to those properties as we understand it in the targeted area. And typically what we do is to reach out to them about how they might be able to propose to preserve their whole parcel, all of the land, whether it's in the targeted green belt area or not. What we have had a lot of success at in the past 15 years is to put together local money, state monies, federal monies, and some limited private monies as well to be able to leverage the price to pay people for conservation easement on their entire property. We started as a land trust that really was focused on preserving open space and natural areas, creeks and rivers, woods along those creeks and rivers. But over time, we really became believers in preserving farmland and blocks of farmland. We believe that we work with farmers who have conservation plans on their property, who use up-to-date conservation practices like no-till, like cover crops, and we believe that it's much better to buffer those wildlife corridors, river corridors, with land that is farmed well versus pervious surface, rooftops, concrete, that will definitely cause the water to flow quickly into those streams, erode the banks, and wash away what topsoil there is. So that's kind of been our model, and we have pretty consistently reached out to all those properties that we highlighted in yellow, as well as those others that are sort of in the gap that goes around Yellow Springs. On the back of that map, then, I've also got a pretty nice watershed map, and that shows the Jacoby Creek sub-watersheds. And our board's had some preliminary discussion. We have a walk set up with the auctioneer to take a look at the property more carefully. I got to walk with some of our board a few years past, along with Matt Arnovitz, and there's a lot of terrain there. It drops off pretty steeply as you head south. That makes it not necessarily the best farmland in some of those areas. And there's a lot of wooded areas, as you can see, that are wooded for a reason. They're really not very easy to farm. And so that's pretty much what you can see as you go down the road. Especially when crop prices were really high 3 years ago or so, people were really trying to cultivate as much as they realistically could. And so if there's trees, if there's wildlife corridors, that probably is not a very good area to farm or an easy area to farm. The creek is probably our biggest priority from our board's perspective at this point. But our board is also very cognizant that we are the local land trust that has long had a partnership with the village and done our best to work with the sentiments of the people in Yellow Springs and Miami Township, which is our home. We work with Clark County and Greene County, and we have had real success in Clark County in recent years, but have continued to chip away on progress on the green belt. And being that this is our home, our board is going to take this really seriously and really want to be proactive in whatever way we can with whatever partners. So at this point, I'm instructed to reach out to potential bidders. We really welcome phone calls. We actually have a board meeting coming up on Monday, and that will be after the walk that we have. And after I hear from whoever, I hear from, I really appreciate people sharing the word with anybody that they know who farms or who has been interested in buying land, including, rural natural land, because some of these parcels are quite nice. On Houston Road, there's a 16-acre parcel, a 10-acre parcel. These don't currently have buildings on them. One of the 5-acre parcels there is very wooded. And so for people that are interested in building something new in a pretty natural property, they might be a very good fit for them. We looking at the parcel map, I just want to point out track 9 to the east is the best farmland. So it would be one that, you know, farmers might be willing to pay a little bit more money for. It also is the closest to the village. It's not in the village limit, but it's the closest to the village. Most of it has not really been in the target zone that particularly for protection from the maps that I can find. Again, from our perspective as a land trust, to work with the entire property, if that's possible, would really be our preference. We are just willing to talk to those people who, you know, would be interested in purchasing the land and preserve it. And we look forward to more conversation with the village. I know that this is happening very suddenly. It was kind of a shock to us how suddenly it occurred. But when you got multiple family decision makers, this can happen.
Krista, do you have any idea what the potential range of per acreage on any of these?
I would say that there's a probably between 4,500 an acre and 9,000 an acre is the range that seems potential for sort of the mix of properties. And I would also say our guess as far as estimate of easement value, the portion of that that would get tied up with a conservation easement and that a landowner could be compensated for, would be something like $1,500 to $2,500 an acre. One thing about an auction, or any sale, actually, is that the market is at play. And so you can have a very good appraisal by a qualified appraiser, and they can, they're always based on recent relevant sales, at least 3 at the unrestricted end, just on the market, what would this land go for? And then they compare 3 properties that have sold with conservation restrictions in place on them. And those appraisals are absolutely scrutinized by especially our federal and our state partners. However, on any given day at an auction, the land will go for what the bidder or bidders are willing to pay. And people have all sorts of motivation going into those auctions. I mean, there's people who are likely to go with a particular parcel in mind. There's people probably who will be interested in, you know, the entire property if they can do that. And then there would be people who would be interested in track 9, either because they want to farm it or speculatively they hope that they would be able to develop it at some point in time.
Is there a minimum?
As I understand it, there is not. It is a pure auction as far as I know.
Okay. Any questions from council?
So you're going to be developing strategies and advising us how we can help.
I would definitely like to come back to you and have further conversation, and I would love to hear from people. That would just really be helpful to us. You know, as I said before, when this has been a planning topic, the whole Jacoby Greenbelt has been just a very big priority, it seems, in people's minds. I think that council's, you know, got to think. I think you've got like $195,000 or something like that in the green space fund. I think a little bit of that is obligated. The land trust has a little bit of money that's available for land acquisition. We have the 1% program that local businesses participate in, and we've put a little money we've gotten from requests, a few thousand dollars more than that. So we have a little bit of money that I think we would be willing, you know, to participate with. This is not as visible as some other properties on the west side that are part of the targeted greenbelt, in that there's not so much road frontage on Dayton, Yellow Springs. Houston will look different. Certainly in terms of the potential for future development on the east side, that could be a matter of concern to the village currently or in the future.
But the obviously the track 8 contains a great deal of the Jacoby Creek.
Yeah,
I mean, that is really the track that
So I think our board's...
is key.
Our board's mission would prioritize that parcel first, because it really is a natural area that is pretty special. Jacoby Creek is really quite amazing. We do have it protected further downstream. It's critical, actually, for Xenia's water supply more than it is for Yellow Springs, because it flows into Little Miami near their water facilities. Mm-hmm.
So, should we hear from citizens? I know Dawn wanted to speak.
I'm hearing from folks that nobody can hear what the speakers are saying without the mic. So, this is for you only, I guess. I'm going to just follow up on what Krista was saying. I didn't know that you had added her to the agenda. But basically, from what I'm hearing is that there are developers who are interested in these parcels, and that we can't trust developers to have our town's best interest at heart. We can't trust them to preserve our rural identity. And we already own the CBE parcel, and we know that we could protect a little bit of a very visual piece of our town's rural identity by protecting the CBE parcel. I just want to keep that as something to consider, because we're talking about anywhere from $2 million to upwards to $5 million if Ryan Holmes gets into the bidding war with someone on these properties. And no matter how steep that slope is, Ryan Holmes can put a house on there. And if they can sell that house for $300,000 or $400,000, and we watch them go like that in Beaver Creek, they could easily do that there. I don't want to sound like I'm here because I don't want development, but I do know what makes our town so special is our rural character. And you can't put that kind of development on the edge of the town and expect that character to stay the same. I know this town came together for the Whitehall Farm, which is a beautiful piece of property and very, very visible because there had a lot of road frontage. But this particular piece, as you mentioned, has an ecological component to it that the Whitehall didn't really even have. This piece has the Jacoby Greenbelt. It actually has this stretch of corridor that is, so far they've protected it well with a riparian border. But we can't even trust that Ryan Holmes or anybody will continue to do that. And I'm just hoping that I'm encouraging the town to come together very much the same way they came together for Whitehall. And in the meantime, I want to also encourage the council to go slow on the CBE parcel, because that will also inform the pressure of development on those parcels that are on the south side of Dayton Yellow Springs. And that's it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I do want to point out that it's township zoning. They don't have water and sewer to do. So there are limitations to what can happen on this property.
Marian Ann and I were very involved in the Whitehall preservation, so I encourage people, because that was very led by citizens. And there was a lot of support by the governmental bodies, you know, the township and the village government. But the people who got that big thing going were a handful of citizens who, some of them hadn't done much anything like that before. So to the extent that people want to see an effort like that occur, it's going to have to come from you guys. So I encourage you to talk to each other and see how you can make something happen. I think the village, you know, will be wanting to play a role, and we want to play a role that's the most effective role we can play. And so, you know, we've got some money we can put into play, but we want to use it as effectively as possible. But it's going to take more than that in this instance, just as it did the last time.
Right.
So,
Council, I'd like to suggest that we plan on having, and this, we can talk about this in executive session since it really is a real estate matter. So I'd like to suggest we add an executive session for our next meeting and invite Krista to come to that. So that would be March 6th.
So we would have an executive session as well as probably a public discussion. Mm-hmm. Again. Yeah.
And just to to let people know, the purpose of the value of having an executive session is that sometimes it is better, especially in buying and selling real estate, to be able to hold your cards close to your chest and not be transparent. So, I mean, whatever comes out of it would definitely come out of it. But that would be the reason for, that is the reason for having an executive session.
Any other comments or questions? No, there's no mic.
What happened to
it? I don't know.
Kristen, to Council Land Trust, I encourage Council to think about putting money towards this. I encourage you to think about Tract 8 as returning it to Forest. And I'm giving you your first check for this purchase.
I just want to thank you so much. I put your money where your mouth is. This is like really good stuff. And just to say, the way that the Whitehall process worked, I was not a part of the land trust. I had moved to Yellow Springs and had friends in Columbus and North Carolina, and they were like, what kind of place is this? Because Whitehall, we were in the thick of Whitehall like right away. And as it turned out, most of that, half of that money, that $1.2 million, really did come from individuals who basically pledged money to be used for conservation easement purpose if it was possible. And I mean, that is a plausible method, again.
And to tell you the truth, I remember when Amy at the YS News, Amy Harper, wrote this editorial, "The clock is ticking." I think we had a month. We had a month to raise money, and we raised $1.2 million in a month. And Marianne and I were very key in helping get that thing going. And I remember my thought processes at the time was, we kind of had an idea of how much it was going to be. And I had this idea, if people thought it was doable, then people would give money. And so, is it doable? And so I thought for myself, who didn't have any money, you know, I could put $2,000 on a credit card. And I thought if everybody was willing to do that, we could make it work. And but it was, and then once that started, I mean, the folks, you know, on the Whitehall Farm now, who played a big role in coming up with the big chunk of money there at the end, that never would have happened. They never would have came forward with that, except that the energy and the passion of the movement to try to save it, they got swept up in it too.
and it really did make all the difference. I mean,
And that's what brought a lot, and then other, you know, other people. But there was this idea we were going to find an angel, some really rich person who's going to save us, and that never happened. It was everybody. I mean, there were some key people, but really, but for the movement at the ground level, I don't think those people necessarily would have thought they could do it. But it was, once we decided we could make it happen, that it was pretty.
But I
amazing.
Think also having the new hearts and having that
yes.
family that was
but, you
willing
know,
to and that's
fun.
That's another
they did not,
piece
they did
of
not
this.
Start. They did not start out there, though. That's
right.
what I'm saying. I mean, they cared about it, but it was really in that everybody got swept up
right.
and everybody did what they could do, and they were able to help in a way that, you know, not too many other people could.
There's
so
one more thing I would just love to add is that I hear from people a lot who are looking for parcels of land to farm, who are thinking about a smaller farm operation.
Mm-hmm.
I really suggest people try to think about forming groups, buyer
yes.
groups.
Yes.
Because it's a lot of people, there's a lot of models, especially East Coast, wherein there's a sort of a centralized organization that owns the land, but there's long-term leases to landholders who then are able to farm that land. Those kinds of projects could be possible. We just don't know how expensive they are, but I think this is, again, an opportunity to put your money where your mouth is. If you've got some funding to invest and have been interested in trying to contribute to a different type of agriculture,
this.
Right. I mean, and I think really focusing on those two large parcels are, that's really the concern, is focusing on those two large parcels.
And the thing that got it kicked off was a big public meeting, just to say. And it wasn't the village council that organized that meeting. It was, again, ordinary people who cared about it. So that's what kicked it off. When there was a big public meeting, was announced, lots of people came, and that's what got it going. So I'm just a little advice to the people who maybe are thinking of trying to make something happen.
Great. Thanks, Krista.
Yeah.
Thanks.
And we'll see you next on March 6th at 6 o'clock up here. We're already moved from citizens. Okay, next item on the agenda is old business, follow-up discussion regarding council's response to the New Year's Eve Day events. As you all know, unfortunately, we weren't able to release the report from the investigator at the meeting on the 13th, as was expected. We will have that report ready to release on March 6th, so we will have at our regular council meeting on March 6th. It's going to be released a few days before, so folks will have an opportunity to look at it before the meeting. Council, any other comments, questions we want to talk about the structure of that meeting?
Are we going to meet in the
well, because we've got the fiber forum also, and we basically just added this to the agenda. Not only are we going to have the executive session, but if there is any action coming out of the executive session, we'll need to have that in public session on the Arnovitz property. So we've just added another item to the agenda of a meeting that was only going to have two agenda items.
But it's an important one, and it'll be a good one to have a big meeting. Well, you want me to, I mean, I can, in terms of the council's response to New Year's Eve Day events, there's two things I wanted to say,
okay,
just to sort of start out. One is that I appreciated Laura Curlis's letter, and I think that we need to consider her request once we get the report. So we will have the report at our next meeting. And so I think that is the time when we can consider her request. The other thing is, we've figured out, I think council figured out a little belatedly, that when we set up the investigation, which we could not do it internally, our chief had resigned, even if we had wanted him to do it, we didn't even have a chief. So we hired an independent investigator. I think, I have to say that I think the council and, some of the staff did not think through how we should set that up. We wanted everybody who had something to say to the investigator to speak to the investigator. You know, we didn't set any kind of cap on the cost. We didn't provide much direction to him. And so I have to say, just in terms of the cost having kind of gotten a lot bigger than anybody would have thought, I feel personally that we need to take some responsibility for that. We just didn't think about it, and we didn't really give the guidance that we should have given. So, I'd like to personally apologize to people that it's ended up being a big bill for the village. And the thing I would like to see come out of a big mistake is that we have a process that we use anytime we have to, occasionally the village, something comes up where there is something that our council cannot handle, and that we give direction and parameters, and that we might even want to have a couple of either put it out for bid or have a couple of other law groups that we can turn to, that we've got some kind of a prearranged, cost structure, so that we don't end up sort of rushing forward the way we did this time and ending up spending a lot of money, more money than I would hope we would have done. So that's all I have to say.
Thanks, Judith, and I absolutely agree with that. As far as the cost, I think we were reacting to the community concern, to our own concern about the events of the evening, and we wanted things to get resolved as quickly as possible. That's all we were thinking about, was moving forward. And didn't manage it well, but we're hoping that the results, and we believe that the results and the report will be something that will help us move forward. And everything that's coming out of this, from the work that the Justice System Task Force is doing and the 365 group and all the other work, that it will set us on course for the kind of police department we all want. And we've been working towards, especially with our interim chief helping us along the way. Anything else?
I just want to say, I think we should think about the structure. I mean, not right
this
second.
Of the meeting?
No, not of the meeting. But next time this happens, that we actually need to legislate.
I think we can get something like that from Patty, a recommendation from staff.
Yeah, you know, it doesn't have to happen tomorrow, but just that we don't lose that.
I mean, we did have legislation. We did.
Oh, no, we passed legislation.
But without any
not much
limited
structures.
Right, yeah, exactly.
Would the retreat be a place?
We could talk about it there. I'm not sure it's that complicated. I'm not sure if it's really that complicated.
We just want
something
in place so that we automatically go that way.
But it isn't just this situation. We've had other people come in from the outside to do things, and in the end, we're not very happy with what they did. So I think anything we can do to
improve
more
the consultant process. That's I would agree with that. So let's talk for just a couple of minutes about the meeting itself. I do know that you know the community is feeling like we should be in the gym. Setting up in the gym is pretty complicated. It does take a lot of time. The fiber folks, you know, we're bringing our consultants in. I know that they're going to be having a PowerPoint, so they're going to be needing to be in here to do their presentation, and it will be most effective in this room. So I'm hoping that we can, I think more chairs will fit into this room than we have in here now. I think that there have been meetings at which we've had more chairs in. We can set up A and B as overflow. I think that there is a way for us to accommodate. Certainly if as many people as came at the first meeting come, we won't be able to accommodate all of those folks, but I think we can accommodate the number that was at the last meeting.
And we're gonna have a moderator
or a runner.
Well, we can have it, right, we can have it, if we do have the over, we will have the overflow set up. That's something that Susan can set up. We will have it set up, and if it's needed, then we will also have a facilitator, someone here to help coordinate any citizens who were in that room who want to come in and speak in this room.
But remember, the last meeting, we had also put out that the report wouldn't be ready, so a lot of people didn't show up. And so, you know, we need to think about that.
Yeah, I wouldn't want to have that whole big meeting, initial meeting, that many people coming and us be in this room. That would not work
right,
very well.
Right, no. I mean, it wouldn't have even, it wouldn't have worked upstairs at all.
No. So I don't know how many people didn't come the last time. There definitely was significantly less people at the last meeting. I don't know how many didn't come because they knew it, you know, the report
was not, hadn't been released.
Because we'd gotten the word out a little bit, that was not greatly, but so yeah, if there's any sense that it could be as more. So I don't know. You know what? I'll let you.
Okay,
I mean,
Judy.
Like
let's get a count on how many seats we can get in. Well, I guess we've got a room count, room max.
You can total about 95 people between the two rooms.
Between the two rooms?
Mm-hmm.
How many in here?
So.
Well, we'll talk about that. We'll talk about that.
Why don't
that.
You guys?
Yeah. Okay, council.
60 people.
In this
60
room.
Is the max. Okay.
And we can squish more into A and B. That's chair. So you could probably fit 120 folks total.
Yeah, because capacity of A and B is what, 75?
Yeah, 73 or 75. So 150.
And just to be clear, you know, when we set that up before, there's a screen in rooms A and B so people can watch the meeting. So the runner
Reverend Randolph
would
is saying the gym. I say, what do you think?
For so small and then you get a huge crowd. Now you have attitude,
Well, if what we would probably do is have a split meeting then, and just have moved down to that space for the, or start down there and then move up for the fiber forum. I guess that's something else we need to talk about during.
That could work. I don't, maybe not quite as many chairs need to be set up. I do think, not, probably not as many as the original meeting will come, I think, but, yeah, I don't know.
Well, it's not to do with chairs as much as it is to do with switching the entire filming capacity.
Oh, and we can't.
Not be able to be live.
We can't, right. Okay, one of the two would not be live. Okay. If we switched. So can you talk to Design 9 about the possibility of not have, I mean, there's no, we could put a screen up down there. There's no reason that they can't do a PowerPoint from there.
We'll figure it out.
Yeah.
Is there any possibility of rescheduling Design 9?
It would probably take another month to get them back out here at this point.
Yeah, I think it's worth considering, just because.
Rescheduling them?
The rescheduling, because we've got two big, potentially big interest items, and we have the report, and we have.
I certainly wouldn't want Design 9 to have to follow this, so I would say that.
No, we wouldn't have much attention for it.
We would want to start with Design 9. So let's think, why don't you do a little bit, just at least research, find out if they have any flexibility.
Yeah, definitely don't want them to follow.
Okay. Did you want to say anything about the vision?
Yeah, I think this relates to next steps on kind of a different point. There are two documents that I thought should be in the packet. One of them is the local policing vision that we passed at the end of 2015. And, you know, a question has come up from Pat DeWees and others about some of the suggestions that 365 Projects has made vis-a-vis this document. One of the things that I've suggested is what's important now, and this is also something that Chief Carlson needs to be involved with, is how do we operationalize this vision statement? Honestly, I think it's a great document. It reflected the community conversations. A lot of work went into it from three council members ultimately. So I guess I would just suggest, as we're talking more about this, I love the idea of guidance as to how to operationalize it and thoughts from Chief Carlson. But I do want this to be reflected upon because a lot of good work went into this. And then the other thing I wanted to say, yeah, go ahead.
I'd like to speak to.
Yes, please do.
So Brian and I were sort of the main authors of the vision for local policing. And so I guess I had a little bit of ego involvement when the citizens came up with something else. But it's made me think about this, and what I've come to is that while certainly council and the community have a big role in saying this is what we would like from our police, I'm not sure that either council or the community should be writing the vision or the goal statement for the police. And I'm thinking that maybe what we should do is say, give the police maybe, well, that we have this document that we already worked on, and what's will be coming, I guess, has come through the 365 Project and will come through the Village Justice System, and saying this is what we want, and we may want to work it, but really hand it to the police department to create from that or those documents. Because truly, the document that we worked on was not institutionalized by the police. And partly it was because it didn't come from the police. Mm-hmm. We got lip service to it, maybe, but it wasn't owned by the police because it didn't come from the police. Mm-hmm. So I'm thinking we might want to think about this process a little, because it's only going to be real in how the police function or the police department if it actually comes from the department.
So what you're suggesting, Mary Ann, is that we take this as somewhat of a roadmap of something
yes.
that at least council has agreed to.
Yes.
We kind of work through our process, work through the justice system task force, work through the work we're doing, and then go back to the police department. By the time we should have a permanent chief at that point, and I would say, you know, probably a little bit more stability in the department. I think there is something to be said for that.
I don't know. Brian's probably seen what 365 has done, and I mean, we can be open about these documents, but I mm-hmm. think that it really needs.
Yeah, I like your roadmap terminology. That's kind of how I'm taking everything in at the present, because there are so many groups offering good advice and suggestions, and so that's kind of where the process is. A lot of these are your second.
I think you have that roadmap, you know, with, you know, some other advice, but I think we're kind of saying the same thing. I mean, I think that is the way to operationalize it, is, you know, now for the police department to sort of embrace it. And I know you've started to do some things already. The other document I thought was important to put in here, because it's been referenced several times, is the five next steps that seem to rise to the top that came out of the community conversations that happened in 2014, 2015. And these have been read off before, but I'll just reference them quickly. Removing ourselves from the ACE task force was at the top of the list, and we did that. Agreement for 40-hour crisis intervention training was suggested, and there actually has been some commitment to that. There's been some issues logistically about how that can be accomplished. But I thought this would be a good reminder, you know, really for Chief Carlson to be thinking about this if you hadn't seen this document. Looking at Mayor's Court and using it more actively, which I think is something that needed a deep dive that the Justice System Task Force has been working on. And my understanding is some recommendations are going to be coming soon about that. The public outreach piece, which, part of this is Patty's initiative, the community police relations initiative. But I think this also speaks to this sort of cultural sensitivity piece that we can continue to work on. And then the final piece, the community committee panel, which I think is something that the 365 Project provided some information about pros and cons on. I think it's going to take a little bit more work, but I thought, especially since I said at our last meeting, I'm focused less on this report and more on how we're going to, you know, institute, execute solutions. And so these are some of the things that rose to the top that I want to make sure that we're keeping in mind. So.
Well,
can I mention one thing?
Please do.
The 40-hour CIT training, we're down to three who don't have it. Two are attending in April.
Cool.
It is one of the trainers in the Greene County area is no longer available, so we're doing that in Montgomery County. Mayor's Court, we met today. I met with both sergeants. We're sending out our detailed list of offenses that we'd like to see put through Mayor's Court. We'll be meeting March 8th with the whole crew, and that's when that will go out. It's 2 days after the next mayor's report. Public outreach, I'm going to go over a little bit of that when I go over the police report.
Great.
Thanks, Chief.
Can we back up a little minute to the vision, when we just talked about the vision in August 19, 2015, and at least I read what you guys did as this was the vision after talking with people in the community. And
the
so
community vision.
This was what the community thought and would like to see in local policing. Okay. Now it's up to then the police department to say, okay, this is the vision. how are we going to implement and what are we going to do to achieve that vision. But to have them write a vision, which I don't think that what you were saying, I think at least the way I looked at it, you were more looking at how are they going to implement it. Am I off there?
Well,
because by having them writing it, then we as council and we as a community can set back, and if it doesn't work, it's right there. He didn't implement it right, blah, blah, blah. But by us saying what we want, then we can better judge how well he's implementing what we want. That's just my, if you told me to write my vision and then go implement, I'm going to write something that's going to be relatively easy for me to achieve. Where this, what we're asking, is not going to be an easy task because he's got different personalities that he's got to be able to meld together. And I just don't want to give him an impossible task.
I think where this kind of, I mean, I know Pat DeWeese had said a lot of times organizations, they create a vision for themselves. And, so it's kind of, it becomes, integral maybe, or maybe not depending. But anyway, this vision is not like we've created the vision for the police department as to what they should do. This is really a different kind of vision statement. It's the community's vision of what they want. Is the way I have understood it. Mm-hmm. And at this point, this 365 subcommittee has offered some ideas of how to, add to it or whatever. And what the process that's going through is that it's being, the Justice System Task Force is going to discuss their recommendations at our next meeting. And, it may be coming back to council, for some addition, revision, however you want to look at it. Just to say, I mean, while we're on all of this, the Justice System Task Force has some recommendations already they want to bring to council, and they're, and I'm just trying to see, they're kind of chomping at the bit now to be very concrete, and so there are a handful of recommendations. We're not discussing them tonight, but I'm just trying to think of, so there's going to be this time frame. So there's, going to be, you're already acting on some of the mayor's court. It really, people just want to see the mayor's court used more. And, so there's on the mayor's court, the use of force policy, the taser policy, Ellis has been intersecting with the chief on that. And so before the end of this meeting, we have to think about, but maybe not right now, just how we're going to, we're going to start to get some complicated proposals from the justice, potentially, from the justice. I don't know how complicated they are, but, they're important. They've got a lot of meat to them, and it could start to be a lot. And so we're going to have to think about how to do that so that they can keep working and we can keep moving the recommendations
right.
through.
I mean, I guess, I think however we treat the vision statement, I think that's probably not a priority right now. I mean, that's something, whether the police department writes it, I think that's something we need to discuss down the road as we're wrapping things up, Pastor, did you have some? There's no reason, I guess, to come up to the microphone other than we can see you.
It'll get you closer to the camera.
Yeah.
Sitting here watching people come to the microphone. I'm wondering why they're leaning in. My name is Bill Randolph. I'm the pastor of the First Baptist Church. I live at 611 Wright Street here in the village. When you look at vision for whatever it might be, it's generally the vision that the organization has. For example, when I worked at Cedarville, there was a vision for the university itself. But each department had its own vision, which gave it ownership. And in order for it to really work, the people who are a part of it have to have ownership of it. And the vision really has to come from the head, if he's chief, if he becomes chief. While there are other parameters that could come into it from the village itself, but there also has to be some input as well from the incoming chief as the vision that he has in order for him to feel a part of it. And then it has to trickle down with his people for them to own it in order to enforce it, notwithstanding what we've already, what's already been developed by council. So I think that in my mind, I see this vision statement is good, but it also has to come from the chief himself. And he must have input, whoever that chief is. Because if not, then he does, how can he have ownership?
Right. Thank you, Pastor. So can we move on to the next? And then when we're doing agenda planning, we'll talk a little bit about Judith's comments and how we're going to start to integrate this work. I think, you know, some of it the next item on the agenda is council goals discussion. So we have, it looks like Judy did some minor updates to this document, adding some dates, some 2017 dates. We also received a letter from Mary Ann, or memo from Mary Ann, about the affordability goal that I will let her talk about. And Judith has some additional goals, so I'm not sure exactly how we want to tackle this, as we are finding out goals are never easy.
Nope, they are not.
Well, I can do two easy things. I did add Melissa to a couple of things,
okay.
Just because they have to do with financial information, and she's the best source of that. So on the second goal, to create and implement a sustainable economic development strategy, that's obviously going to have something to do with the loan fund. And so I added her under persons responsible to that one. And then also the first goal on the second page, which was work with community organizations, commissions, staff to develop a plan to reduce energy use and increase environmental sustainability. From the discussions that we've been having at the Energy Board, that may also have a financial component. So anything to do with that would have to run through Melissa.
Okay. Brian, did you have some things you were changing or updating to the transportation goal?
I mean, they were in the packet last time.
Okay.
So.
And did those get integrated into this?
Yeah.
Okay.
So this took the changes from each document and put them all onto one.
Okay. So, Mary Ann, do you want to, well, let's go to Judith, because Judith had some recommendations for new goals. Do you want to talk about those?
Well, yeah. The Justice System Task Force review and update, I got the impression, I mean, we had kind of these broad goals, you know, from last year, but I got the impression, you know, that council felt it would be helpful to be a little more concrete. And so I would see these actually just getting rid of the, I tried to organize it. Anticipated results, just leave it the same. But the activities, there's a list of them, I'm sorry. But they may not fit in one box. But they're kind of what we're doing.
Okay.
And it's fairly concrete, so I thought it was kind of useful to be more concrete. So that's all. I mean, they're... I'll read them off since you guys out there may not have this in front of you. So the Justice System Task Force review and or assess this, it should just be the Justice System, not task, review and update that I had on my paper. Justice System review and update. The anticipated results is a stronger, more effective mayor's court that incorporates restorative justice principles and has an increased referral rate. Strengthen public trust in the PD across race, age, and income groups, increase public understanding of the YSPD policy and practice, and police department policy to reflect best practices and community values. So the more specific things we hope to do this year are, well, I don't know that it really fits under here, but I put hire a permanent chief, seems relevant. Increased understanding of police department practices. I don't know, it sounds very repetitive, so sorry about that. Take steps to align police department priorities of enforcement with community values. Strengthen relationships between the police officers and community members across age, race, and income. I don't know, it's just repetitive, so maybe this doesn't make sense, I don't know. Review and act on the Justice System Task Force recommendations. Review and update police department training. Okay. Determine if we hire a prosecutor for our mayor's court, and if so, the guidelines by which they work. Determine prosecutorial priorities of the mayor's court based in community values. Provide guidelines to increase use. It sounds like some of this is already in process. And first steps in integrating restorative justice practices with the mayor's court. So I don't know. I'm not. It feels like it's sort of repeating.
It'd be tightened up.
Yeah, it feels like it's probably more detail than we need, but.
Okay, yeah. It ended up being longer than. Okay, so Mary Ann and I can try to finalize it, and just if you guys are kind of okay in general with it, give it to Judy for our resolution, well, unless there's any particular problems you see there.
Yeah, I would just say a thought about how to tighten it up.
Yep.
So there's, the decision about the mayor's court piece. Maybe it doesn't have to be like three statements that should happen.
Can I ask a question? Is there a reason that what's already there can't work?
I thought I was being asked to do something to be more specific by the council.
For example, one thing that's not there is, the use of taser, use of force. So that's why, I was thinking about when you started to say things that could happen this year. So a permanent chief, that should happen this year.
Okay, yep.
The mayor's court decision should happen this year. Updating our use of force taser policy. So I don't know. I mean, so some of the things that I know from happening.
But we've got YSPD practice and policy.
I don't think
we've got restorative justice practices, mayor's court.
Yeah.
I mean, it really does seem in what we've already got there, we have the general.
It's fine.
Outline.
We don't have to change it at all.
And I think, I think we should add permanent chief.
Okay, that's fine.
I think that
that's
needs
fine.
To be added.
That's fine. Let's keep it simple. I'm all for that. I don't know why.
I mean, we've captured racism, we've captured drug issues, so I think those were really the main issues that we were.
Yep, that's fine.
Okay.
I like the dates being in there to keep us focused.
Yeah, 27, yeah. Now we're to 2017. Okay, yeah, sorry about that. Okay, so that was that one. Then, there's the affordability overview that Mary Ann has, and I have some specific ideas on that. There's the auditing the landlord responsibility for utility bills. Should I wait for that?
Yeah,
I'll wait for that.
Have
yep.
That as a
okay.
Separate
then there's a couple other things that I have here. Three. One probably can integrate into the energy one can go integrate into one of the other ones. One is, and I didn't know where to put it, a new goal, so I made it a new goal. Integrate diversity hiring best practices and village hiring practices. And the anticipated results is to integrate these hiring protocols into our policies, and the activities is to research best practices and adopt legislation. And I also suggested we share findings with other village organizations and businesses. And I suggested that Ruth Ann play a role because she's our HR person and the council. And I don't know if there's anybody else. Patty
would be.
So that's one. So I don't know if council wants to think about that one a minute. Or should I just go through them all?
Yeah, I don't think it integrates into any current goal.
So it would have to be a new one, right?
And
I don't think it's a huge amount of work, actually.
Yeah, no, I like
sent
it.
That. I sent those best practices pieces, and I think it's pretty concrete, and that's what we could. That's what I would like to see.
So we can add
to.
That when I'm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and then a new goal: research and consider becoming a sanctuary community. And this is regarding, actually Laura had just emailed me a little piece of an article in the New York Times where the Trump administration intends to ask police departments to participate in immigration policy. And so I think, I talked to Lori Askeland about this goal. Cleveland and Cincinnati are sanctuary communities. I put them as resources and they're officials, but I'm guessing there's been community groups involved with this. Cleveland, I think, has been a sanctuary city for very long. And Cincinnati just has become a sanctuary city, I think, in January. And so I would like us to consider becoming one, which means we would not participate in those kind of things.
I'm working on a resolution through HRC. Probably we would come to the second meeting in March with a draft resolution.
I mean, I was wondering if that needed to be a goal.
It doesn't need to be a goal.
Maybe it's, because I thought it was already being worked on.
Okay.
So is that's what you're saying, Mary Ann?
That's fine.
Yes.
Okay. As long as it's being worked on.
I absolutely support it, but
we need to understand
the threats of funding cuts. I don't understand what that
Lori
means.
Lori said, we need to understand what it all means. I'm with you there.
And very different way. There are different ways of, there's no sanctuary city.
Right.
I mean, it means different things in different places.
Right. And it's my understanding that the city of Dayton actually is probably a pretty good resource, because Nan Whaley they've been doing it.
They're a welcoming city.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. We don't get much federal funding.
True.
And then the final thing was just on the energy use, what the energy board, just leaving the goal to replace efficiency smart, the energy board's working on that. And I discussed with the board that starting a yearly tree planting project, and there seemed to be openness. Patty had some good ideas about it. And I have not talked to the tree committee, but I would hope they would help us with that. And it would require a small amount of funding.
I also just learned, related to the tree thing, and in particular, there's a Tree City USA designation. Yeah. I can put in that information into the next packet. It's very interesting for us to look at, and given all the work that we do.
Yeah, my former community was a tree city.
Yeah, so I think it would be great.
With the program.
Okay. And a starting point is to have a group in place like the tree committee, mm-hmm. and then we'd have to fund it at maybe $3,000 or something.
Okay. Yeah. And Patty was talking about the schools. You know, getting the schools, the students involved, and we could connect it to Arbor Day celebration and all that kind of stuff.
Okay, sounds great. So then, Mary Ann, do you want to talk about the affordability goal?
Yeah. Well, when I started out, I was thinking of having a discrete goal regarding affordability, but the more I thought about it, well, one, I thought there should be more discussion at the council table and really with the community. I mean, clearly affordability has been something that's been discussed as an issue in the community for a couple decades, probably. Especially the last couple decades. And so I thought this would be an opportunity to keep the discussion enlarged for a while, even if we want to hone in on our goals. But as I started thinking about it, I thought of it really as a sort of meta goal, that every single goal probably has issues that could be looked at in regard to affordability. And so one thought I had was that we institutionalized very intentionally looking at affordability for every goal that we have. How does it impact affordability? And then also within various goals, and I mentioned some of them, we can easily pull out how that particular goal impacts affordability. An example would be developing the glass farm. Clearly, we need more, not only affordable housing as it's defined federally, but rental housing, various kinds of rental housing, or even more housing probably would increase affordability in Yellow Springs. So that's an example, and we could look at various examples in various goals. And so one option would be to say, you know, within each goal, target something about affordability in that goal. And then I thought, you know, we can pay lip service to a lot of things. and not get much done. So it might make sense that every year we target something that we know we could do within that year to increase affordability. And the suggestion I made was to target utilities. And Judith has mentioned some things she'd like to see done in regard to analyzing our policies around utilities. But I listed three things that we could implement. And one would be, one is what Judith suggested. One is institutionalizing the utility roundup program where people can donate money in their utility bill to go to a fund to help lower income people. And the other thing I listed was tasking the Energy Board and developing a program to effectively teach people how they can lower their utility costs and put money into that program so that whether it's buying shower heads or light bulbs or whatever it is, or whether it's putting money into a program, bringing people in, that we put money into something. And I guess the last thing is that I said in this one page thing was affordability mostly impacts lower income people and low moderate income people. Middle and especially upper middle and people with more money, yeah, they have to pay more money maybe to live in Yellow Springs, but they have money, they can do it. So, I mean, when we're thinking about affordability, I think it's important that we really think about the groups that it primarily targets. I mean, that it impacts the most. So
one thing we could do is just add affordability comments in the anticipated results, including a quantifiable and qualitative factors. Mm-hmm. I mean, we could just, complete the new water plant and update, that right there we raised water rates to pay for the water plant.
Yeah, we did, but given that we're also putting a different kind of softening process in, that will mean a little bit less that people, either they won't have to have a water softener or they won't have to pay as much salt for their water softener.
Or replacing.
Or replacing equipment.
So that's a way that's sort of a balancing something.
Right.
I mean, and there are other, for example, we could help people learn how to not use as much water. Mm-hmm. I mean, there are things people don't think, when I stand in the shower for 15 minutes, that's going to have an impact on my water bill. Things like that.
So,
well, I do want to say I really like this way of thinking, and I agree that we should be thinking more concretely about how affordability fits into some of these goals. The other thing that we might want to consider is adjusting one of our village values. We haven't really ever touched those, and maybe there's a place for affordability in those, overarching. I mean, when I read what you wrote, it made me think about that too. Mm-hmm. So.
Yeah, I'm glad. I appreciate that you've put this together, Mary Ann. The other thing I was thinking, the one other suggestion I had under this was, and when is our levy up next time? How long?
It was 2015, wasn't it? It was just a year ago, year and a half ago.
It's 2015, so we got till 2019. Anyway, one of the things I was, as I'm approaching retirement, thinking about is just our level of taxation. And I had suggested that we be meeting with the township and the school board, maybe to have just have a conversation about that, because we're all have a piece of the public purse and we're all trying to provide these public services. And I just think we're going to have to keep thinking about this because the cost, the taxation in the town is high. And I understand why. It's very obviously why, because we're small, and providing these services, you know, it's costs a lot per, more per person than if we were a larger community. But I think we really have to be, as a whole community, you know, not just the council, not just the school board separately, and, you know, we're going to have to be thinking about these things in a certain sense together as we try to, you know, provide the public services people want. But I don't want to see people be priced out of town, you know, and I'm fearful of that as we're moving forward, as, you know, it seems like more taxes coming from the state are, you know, potentially going to be diminished. And I just, I don't know the answer, but I just thought, you know, it's something that we're all struggling with, all three bodies, so maybe it's worth just keeping our awareness of it.
And both of those entities are looking at potential, well, definitely the Miami Township is having, is going to have a levy on the ballot in May, and it sounds like the schools may be looking in that direction also.
Yeah. And that's why, and then, you know, ours is a little further off to renew, and, you know, I mean, I just think we all, I was thinking as a, the elected officials together, you know, need to be thinking about these things and at least talking about, keeping it in the front of our minds that it, you know, the more levies we have, the higher, you know, our levies are, and there's always a good reason for it. But, you know, people aren't going to be able to live here that we want to be here. I mean, and it's, so I think, so I was suggesting we just have that we kind of invite a conversation, you know, have a meeting once this year, sort of just thinking about, you know, that whole question. I don't know exactly what it would look like, but just.
Yeah, I think. I mean, I think it's a possibility. I think the schools are probably going to be pretty much enmeshed in their own process. I don't know what you think about it, but they're kind of, you know, they're working on a plan. They have a consultant. They're working on a plan as to, you know, kind of their next step with their facilities. So, and I'm sure that they will be going through this. I mean, this affordability will be an aspect. I mean, they're going to be coming to the community to ask if they're willing to support it or what they're willing to support. So, but I mean, we've typically had that joint meeting as a goal every year, and we haven't done it for a long time. So how do we want to, how are you recommending, Mary Ann, that we integrate the affordability piece into the goals?
Well, I wanted us to have a discussion, which we have done. I don't know if there's going to be any more suggestions from the community. Kate Anderson had mentioned food insecurity as an issue, which I hadn't listed, but that's something that can be listed. So.
I just have one, you know, number two, around the program for low income, I think a more bigger issue is folks that are on fixed income.
Well, it...
Piggybacking on what Judith said about we're getting older, and retirement, you have a fixed income, okay, with... The other choice is to go back to work. Okay, low income could say that you could get another job or whatever, but people on fixed income, they're usually there because they reach that stage where they're unable to work anymore. You know, because most folks, you know, they don't really retire at 65 anymore. They work as long as they can. Maybe in the 70s or above, but at some point they become fixed income, and we don't really address that. And I thought what I heard when people were complaining about high bills and so forth, there were a lot of fixed income people that were voicing a concern, not so much low income.
So you don't think they would be considered low income?
No, because I have. fixed income that's way above what is considered low income. But as my taxes keep going up, my income still is assessed to be high, but it ain't going to grow only with maybe a 0.5% or whatever cost of living if you get down. So, and with fixed income, you have a health issue or whatever, that can really affect your fixed income or food prices or whatever. So we're kind of in the same boat, but we're not classified, not nearly as low income.
I mean, I don't know that the discussion of affordability has to differentiate income levels. I mean, I think it is about affordability, and if someone is in a higher income category, they can afford to live here, and it's not an issue. It's people at other places on the spectrum, be it a fixed income or be it a lower income. So, it's just, you know, I think you're hearing support for integrating those ideas into this. It's just, how are we going to do it? You know, I would like to wrap these up at some point and move on. Yes.
I'm actually working on some things here that I can share with Mary Ann.
Okay.
And see if she's, I'm just
sounds good.
Notes.
Okay.
Great.
Sounds good. Okay, council retreat. So it's been set. Okay, where did this go? It's been set for the 24th, April 24th. It will be at Antioch University Midwest. I think Judy has it all set up. And we did get some recommendations. We'd gotten some recommendations from Mary Ann on some topics, and we have some here from Judith. Mary Ann, do you want to review the topics that you had suggested?
I don't remember. Sorry.
The one you just, what was it earlier? About consultants.
What kind of processes we use and what we ask for up front when we hire any kind of consultant.
Right.
Sorry, is there an opportunity to comment on the council goals?
Sorry, Chris. Yeah, come on up.
Okay. We're just...
So Chris Bongiorno, I'm at 245 Allen Street, and I'm speaking on behalf of the Board of Trustees for Home Inc., and I commend the conversation at council here about affordability. In particular, Home Inc. is concerned about housing affordability, and we've been working for almost 20 years now on that issue, and it's not an issue that's going away, as it's clear. It's getting to be more intense. We have 22 community land trust properties in our holdings right now, which will be permanently affordable to low to moderate income households, and we have a lot of additional opportunities coming up in the next several years. Emily Seibel, the executive director, would have loved to have been here tonight, but we have a community meeting at the Baptist Church tonight to talk about the six-unit Forest Village Homes project, which some of you are probably familiar with. That will be a rental project, one of our first multifamily rental projects to be built by Home Inc. and owned by Home Inc., and it'll be reserved for six units of senior and disabled renters. So that's big news. They're getting community feedback at that meeting tonight about that project, but also about community-wide goals related to affordable housing. So hopefully we'll have more to share on that. And really there are some big opportunities to develop more property with Home Inc. at the lead. And I've been encouraged as a one-year board member now at how capable and how productive the small staff is. And so, I commend you for this conversation and hopefully seeing those affordability goals integrated into your 2017 council goals. And as a non-Home Inc. board member, I also commend you for your transportation-related goals. I'll talk more about that in new business.
Thanks, Chris.
Well, and sort of piggybacking onto that, and I just threw out some suggestions for the retreat because it's an all-day meeting when council sits down together and has some time to talk, and you know, it's and we usually have some limited things we focus at, and the Glass Farm developing a master plan for the glass farm, you know, was started on our goal last year, I think, and we didn't get too far, unfortunately. And I just think it's a big, it's such a big thing, so I had suggested maybe a place to try to get that kicked off a little better is at the council retreat. So I don't know if council feels that that makes sense, but just to say, I think we need to figure out a way to get that going. And I had also suggested that our planning department staff, that's one person, Denise Swinger, that she could play a more active role here in helping us because, you know, we're working, you know, like some of us, three of us work full-time on top of being on council, and it takes some expertise. And, I mean, Mary Ann's been trying to, but she's got her hat in a million rings, and it's just a lot. So I was hoping, you know, with some professional assistance, we could start to move off the dime and start getting a little further along. I know some little things have been happening too.
Right. But, we actually, I hope to have a report from Ken LeBlanc on the glass farm by the 20th, the March 20th meeting, on the possible uses of the remaining property. We walked it last week.
Okay. But getting back to the retreat and my suggestions, I mean, there's so many things we could be talking about, and these were just some that were in the top of my head, which was, you know, maybe hearing from the chief, just sort of getting, maybe it would be like an executive session, just an internal of how things are going in the police department after he's been there another month or so. And then the glass farm master plan, I just had suggested as next steps. I also have been thinking about Antioch College and the communicating with the president, and had suggested we invite him to our retreat and have a conversation with him. It's such an important institution of the village. And then there is a leadership training. I'm not quite sure what's happened with everything else going on. There's some updates that I thought too we might do, but you know, there could be probably 30 other things that we could also be thinking about, so I don't know. And I'm sure the president and the vice president have been thinking about what should happen at that retreat, so I just threw these ideas out because they seemed kind of good.
Yeah, no, I think those are good. Brian, did you have any?
Yeah, I had two additional things. One is talking about executing our goals, and I guess that's why I've kind of been making this push towards like thinking about what we can do by year. And you know, so the glass farm falls under that, and there are some other things. And it's kind of a connected thing, but I guess, you know, we usually do talk about commissions, and I'm thinking in particular about revisiting the sort of how do commissions make recommendations to council, and in particular since this is a pretty ambitious year, and so part of how we build capacity is through our commissions and task forces. So I think we should think about that a little bit, just so we can smoothen out that process.
I think that was actually a recommendation that Mary Ann had that you sent out in an email.
Yeah, but I was also talking about how we network, not just with commissions, but with organizations that are not part of the village government, how we.
Mm-hmm. I mean, one thought I have is related to the police department is that because we've been spending so much time on that in executive sessions and in regular meetings, maybe that's actually something we should not have on the retreat agenda. Just. Not that we don't want to hear from you, Brian, but
no retreat for me.
I mean, I'm not saying, it's just a thought. You know, I definitely think, you know, maybe that the overarching discussion item of executing goals, and then start to get specific. I mean, I think that the easiest one is the water plant. That's happening. I mean, that's happening. So maybe go through here and really be a little bit even, and maybe we just need to do it within these goals, is to be really specific about exactly what is happening. And maybe that's something we should do before the next meeting, before when we finalize these. Because some of them are still really ambiguous and don't get very pointed. So the idea of executing goals, I think, is a good one. I think the consultant process can probably be
be dispatched. And again, I'm not sure that that's something I want to talk about during the retreat, because I think it's something that we can talk about during a meeting. I don't think it, to me, it doesn't rise to the level of a retreat topic. But I agree with the leadership training updates. I'd like to hear where that is. You know, maybe we invite Tom for lunch, to share lunch with us.
The president, mm-hmm. the NA president.
Tom Manley, yeah.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. So let's, I think this looks good. I mean, you know, I didn't really have any. I was counting on all of you to come up with the big ideas. Jerry, did you have anything specific you wanted to?
Well, I like the one on discussing just how we go about hiring consultants.
You do? Okay.
Yeah, because, you know, we don't have a public plan. I mean, we never really talk about it until we have to do it.
So maybe that could be, I mean, that seems like that could potentially be a pretty short one.
Yeah, but I think we should at least come up with some guidelines, some discussion. You know, and to me, we can't put that on Patty. It's got to be on.
Well, I mean, I think we would, I would ask Patty to come to us with a proposal or with a strategy.
I have.
Okay.
Already.
Okay. So, and then we can kind of review that and understand it. So let's just, you know, and I mean, how do folks feel about more conversation about the PD? I mean, do you think that that's something?
I hear what you're saying.
We're going to get that.
Well, I think, yeah, there's also this issue of, you know, what citizens want to be involved in. And so all those discussions are going to happen again anyway.
Mm-hmm. Right.
In our regular meetings.
So are you supporting not having it at the
yes.
Okay.
Right.
That's fine.
Okay.
You can come for lunch.
Okay, so we'll flesh these out. And okay, what's next? Update on the CBE forum schedule?
It's March 2nd, 7 to 8:30. We will meet in rooms A and B. We will divide into small groups, and our village mediators will facilitate. We'll come back at 8 to report out. Susan's going to be there to film that piece. She is not going to be filming the individual sessions. I don't think there's a good reason to do that. And then I mentioned we'll come back with an alternate for the second follow-up conversation.
Okay. Sounds good. Next item on the agenda is the active transportation proposal. I will ask Brian to introduce that briefly.
Since Chris is here and he's waited so patiently, we'll have Chris do that.
Bradley, thank you. Again, Chris Bondorio, and now I'm representing the Active Transportation Committee. Which is a citizen committee. It's not an official commission of the village. We learned of a new source of funding through Ohio Department of Transportation and the Ohio Department of Health. It was announced in January, deadline March 3rd. It's the Active Transportation Grant Program, $1.7 million in state federal highway safety funds that are being used to jumpstart the state's Active Transportation Action Plan, which was approved last year. And the focus is on increasing safety for active transportation users and increasing the number of Ohioans traveling by active mode. So $1.7 million spread across the whole state. There's a max of $250,000 per application. We're not going for that much. The eligible projects include education, infrastructure, policy and planning, and data collection. And included in that policy and planning section is active transportation plans. So our committee felt that developing an active transportation plan in accordance with the village council's goal of developing an integrated multimodal transportation network for the village made sense for us to really get that going. It also makes sense because we're going to be looking in the very near future at updating the comprehensive plan. We had a conversation with Lee Swinger today. We met with Village Manager Patty Bates to talk about the opportunities here. This would be an application submitted by the village to ODOT, and the Active Transportation Committee would pledge a lot of its time and personal expertise to help lead that study and planning process. We are not asking for a specific dollar amount. We would be asking for technical assistance in the form of one of ODOT's task order consultants, which they would then lend to this process. Remains to be seen how exactly that works and how much control we'll have over that process, but that will be important to us, obviously. Again, the deadline is March 3rd. They'll announce the grants in May, and then the money will be available, according to them, in fiscal year 2017-18. So, you know, we may start later this summer and have a planning process that proceeds into next year. But there will be, obviously, opportunity to develop the scope and everything and make sure that the village is comfortable with a consultant that's being put forward by ODOT, or if we want to recommend our own. I think it's kind of an iterative process because it is a new funding source. So there's a lot of collaboration amongst local groups, and then hopefully coordination with Miami Valley Regional Planning. ODOT obviously will be at the table. Green County Health is very involved in this, and they helped with some components of the application that we drafted and sent around. So anyways, any other questions or any questions?
Are we writing a letter of support? Do you want that?
This is our grant. We need to hear from Patty.
Right, and we did meet today. Chris and Brian and I met, and then Denise joined us later. I'm supportive of doing this, primarily because there's no match, and we will be working with a consultant who will give us a lot of expertise that, you know, we don't necessarily have. I mean, we do have people like Chris who know a lot about this, but you know, this is someone who can lend a certain level of expertise to us, and ODOT's going to foot the bill. And so I think it's definitely a step in the right direction to get the active transportation plan in place, then make it part of the comprehensive plan as the Planning Commission updates it, and just go from there and use that to inform a lot of our infrastructure decisions.
Yeah, I think I'll add a couple things. We don't know if this funding will be available in the future, you know, so this could just be a one-off. And I think my feeling was that we wouldn't be able to get this active transportation plan going this year, but this is an opportunity with that technical assistance to potentially do that. The other great thing about working with ODOT is down the road when we think about funding, ODOT basically, you know, through NVRPC controls the transportation alternative funds. So if we have a plan that passes their muster, then that'll put us in a better position. And so, you know, we're ultimately talking about solving the sidewalk problem and everything, you know, beyond that.
So just to understand, this is our grant. We're not supporting their grant. No, this is our grant. They're supporting our grant.
I looked at the top of the page.
It is sometimes, I mean, this application, which has been on screen for a minute here, it's so simple. It seems like an introductory letter of interest application.
Right.
And then they would ask you for a full application.
Right.
There's no opportunity to attach letters of support. There's no resolution from council or the village that's required.
Yeah.
Some of that stuff will probably follow if we're awarded a grant or the technical assistance, that they'll ask for some of that stuff. But at this point, it's a very short form with very strict limits in character.
Chris did a great job putting this together, and you know, I think we've got the expertise with this group of folks. I think we've got the commitment. I'm supportive of it. I just wanted everybody to be clear, and I wanted to make sure staff was on board.
Yeah, and I would like to have a consensus of council on this, that everybody supports it.
Well, does somebody want to make a motion?
Motion.
Motion to support.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Chris.
Thank you, Chris. Great work.
And the
thanks to the rest of the committee, too.
Yeah, transportation committee.
Okay, and I'll bring this up.
Okay, we're moving on to Patty's report.
Okay, I'm going to go on to another grant that we're possibly thinking of applying for that kind of ties into the active transportation, and it's
It's a regular grant that comes out from the, and I never get this right when I say it, it's one of the health, the Ohio AAP, which is, has to do with...
Association of Pediatric...
American Academy of Pediatrics.
Thank you. It's a good thing you didn't leave yet.
I only know that because we talked about it.
Yes. And they, every year, they have grants to buy bicycle helmets that you then, in turn, give out to children to wear during month of May as Bicycle Safety Month, and the police department does activities. We already do these activities with the students at Knowles Lawn. But it's a no-match grant, and you apply, and you may or may not get the helmets to hand out. We do have some helmets left from a grant that was previously applied for by the Active Transportation Committee, but we don't know how many we have. So we're going to take a quick inventory of those and then apply for this. This is due on March the 2nd, so, and I just literally got this morning. So I would like also a consensus of council to do this. It fits in with the, what we've been trying to do with bicycle safety, with Judy, with the lights and the vests and all of those different things. It fits right in with that and Bicycle Safety Month.
So can we get a motion?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Just real quick through my report, Design 9 was going to be here on March 6th, but I have emailed them to see if they can change that to the March 20th meeting. I will have to wait and see. I will tell you that they did say we got over 900 responses to our survey. So they are currently mapping those to make sure that they are all within the village limits. But if we got that many, that's an enormous amount for a village this size. So that's incredible. You will see there that my answer to one of the questions that was asked at the February 6th meeting was the cost of the outside investigation. I have two bills from Dave Williamson of Beezer, Greer, and Landis. Right now, that total amount is $45,311.24. Dave did tell me that roughly half his time and Matt's time, was spent interviewing people. They interviewed 42 people, including 32 citizens, two former chiefs, eight village personnel. Those interviews ranged from 30 minutes to 3 hours in length, and averaged an hour and a half. They reviewed dash cam videos, dispatch logs. They reviewed body cameras from the officers who responded, mutual aid on part of the 99. They reviewed all of the relevant sections of the Ohio Revised Code, as well as the operations manual for the police department and our personnel manual. They spoke and met with various council members and myself. They also, one thing that's not on there is they did talk several times to Laura as the representative for Mr. Carlson, Laura Curlis, and John Paul Ryan, as well as to the prosecutor. So those are the things that we have for right now. The Dayton Yellow Springs Road Infrastructure Project, the revised plans are done, and the project can proceed once AT&T moves the fiber line, which they have agreed to do.
Yay.
So yay. And the solar array. Guess what I'm doing next week? I'm signing the power purchase agreement on the solar array, finally. So the good news is that the delay actually got us a lower price per megawatt hour, because this new efficient panel came out, and they're going to put in these more efficient panels that are going to generate more electricity, which gives us the, we buy less off the grid because we're buying more from the solar field, but it, we're also getting it at $3 per megawatt hour cheaper than what we were getting it. So that's a little bit of good news.
Yeah.
That's all I have, unless anyone has any questions.
So I do want to go back to the cost of the investigation. So how detailed of a sort of accounting of the hours do we have?
Right now, all I have is the hours for Dave Williams, the hours for Matt Swellentrop, I can never get his name right, and for the paralegal.
Okay.
And then the ancillary costs for things like LexisNexis research, postage.
Because, okay. I mean, you know, two things. One is, I mean, lawyers do track, mm-hmm. you know, every quarter of an hour.
Mm-hmm.
So it seems to me that we could get a more detailed accounting. And then secondly, I want to make sure that we review this, you know, before we, I guess, accept the bill.
Melissa?
I did not submit a formal written report. I'm basically working on financial statements from 2016. I've got those done. I'm working on the notes, and those will be submitted to the state by the end of this month. And I've already been submitting all of the requested documents to the auditors that will be performing the 2016 audit, so that they've got a head start on everything, so they should be here soon. There is a separate audit that I think all of council was emailed about. It's looking at 2015 Ohio Police and Fire. They, the pension contributions and the village's processes for making sure that those were accurately submitted and withheld. And they just randomly picked different municipalities across the state, and we were one of them. So it's just a half an hour that they come in and they sit and they look at it, make sure everything's on the up and up. So other than that, okay. That's it.
Great, thanks. Chief Carlson?
Some of this we've already gone over, policy changes. Use of force, use of taser, use of verbal force. In April, got some exciting stuff. We're gonna begin working with residents and some local students. I met with Susan Lee, the Dean of Students at Antioch. They've offered, we're going to walk with officers, so officers will be escorted around town. We are looking for some local volunteers that would like to assist with that, kind of give officers a little history of Yellow Springs as they walk with them around town. On a lighter side, I also have Joe Ayers promised to escort officers around in his 1958 BMW sidecar, which I think would be neat. And we're proud to announce that former YSPD officers Luciana Lee and Stephanie Bennington, formerly Spurlock, will be back on the beat in the village starting March 6th. Both Luciana and Stephanie were a perfect fit here in the village, and we're very lucky to have them back. The department will be starting a three-phase training program beginning March 8th. The first full-day session will focus on de-escalation through approach and interactions. This will be one of three six-hour sessions eight-hour sessions designed to change the way we've been traditionally trained to engage with citizens who may be in crisis. The department is adding to our performance evaluations a new category that will dominate the existing review categories, which consist of traffic, warnings, citations, and criminal cases. The additional category will highlight and record the number of interactions officers have with residents and visitors in the community. Many of you know the two new crossing signs that Jason and the crew placed on Xenia Avenue were struck by a vehicle and dragged up 68 almost to Young's. In fact, there is still a scrape in 68 all the way up the road. Crew was able to, they did a great job in retrieving the signs, repairing them as best as possible, and they're now back in place, not necessarily standing upright.
They're a little dirty. They're a little a little the worse for wear.
Well, I thought it was a truck that drug the sign, but it turns out it was a Volkswagen.
Oh, no. Are you? Oh, my God.
So, because of the additional concerns I received after last council meeting expressed regarding speeding, we are adding a third digital sign on Fairfield. That will be placed on Fairfield Pike, exactly where to be determined.
Great, thank
and,
you.
And Brian, the first meetings between the officers and the facilitators in the Community Police Relations Initiative will be, I believe it's April 6th and 15th, are the 2 days that chosen, the first Thursday and the second Saturday of each month for these regular meetings between the officers and the facilitators for right now.
Sounds good, thanks.
Thank you.
Thanks, Chief.
Thank you.
Judy?
It's been extremely busy, and thank you very much for renewing my contract.
You're welcome. Thank you. Okay, board and commission reports. Jerry?
None. We didn't meet.
Okay. Brian?
The only other thing to report for Economic Sustainability Commission is continued work on the revolving loan fund. And the plan is to bring a recommendation to council soon to get that restarted. For the Arts and Culture Commission, I actually just wanted to, you know, mention again, and it kind of came up related to the kindness banners, that Patty, we have something in our ordinance about how those banners can only stay up for 21 days?
That's what Johnny and Denise are telling me, yes.
Okay.
I have not personally looked up the ordinance, but yes.
I guess I'd like to just, not that we ever have time, but at some point just kind of look at what the reasoning is behind that. Maybe it could just be briefly mentioned in your manager's report.
I can look at it. My guess would be that it's because we get so doggone many requests to put banners up.
Right. And during the season, I mean, it goes from street fair to, I mean, during the summer, there is a banner up almost constantly. So that, I think when we're in a situation where there aren't any competing banners, I'm not sure I understand the reason for removing them.
Yeah.
I would.
And then otherwise, the Arts and Culture Commission is planning to submit a request for a budget, which, you know, makes me kind of think about, I know all our commissions now, you know, have the ability to do that. And maybe that's part of kind of thinking about a format for how that can be done. And we do have art in the Bryan Center Gallery now.
Who's the artist?
That is Aaron Smith. And the current plan is to have an opening reception on March 17th, but I need to confirm that. And we'll put that out as soon as we know for sure.
Okay. Judith.
Hang on a second here. Why don't you go ahead, Marianne? I'm looking for some.
Okay. There was no mediation meeting, although I did meet with John Gudgel, but we reported that last time regarding the police community relation. I have not met with school board liaison. HRC is planning a retreat on March 4th, Saturday. And at our last meeting, we talked some about the Sanctuary City idea. We also met with Brian Carlson, Chief Carlson, and had some discussion about how HRC might be involved in helping have programs or events around community police relation. Environmental Commission met. We just updated on all the projects, which are the Clean Ohio grant for the glass farm. And there was discussion around that. There was discussion around the lawn ordinance that was requested by Planning Commission. And the Environmental Commission essentially voted to not vote on it or to not recommend any change. We had some discussion about the water, source water protection, and climate action. But there were no, other than the lawn ordinance, non-decision, I guess. There were no decisions. The Beaver Management Task Force met. We reviewed the performance of the two flow devices that were put in the fall. They're both, and that's in the creek that goes into the glass farm. They are both functioning, even though one has partially come apart. But together with some work around the culvert on Thistle Creek, the water level in that stream has dropped at least a foot and a half, maybe 2 feet. So it's much more manageable level. Also, the beavers seem to have moved from that stream where they were somewhere back into their lodge. It seems that way. And then if you walk along around the glass farm, you can see where they've been eating some of the willows that are sprouting back up again. And so they, I guess they're relatively happy.
Before we move on, so does that mean we're back to with the lawn ordinance that you don't have to mow your grass until
July? No,
the
Planning Commission asked the Environmental Commission basically to make a decision on whether ordinance should stay as it is, which says you only have to mow around the perimeter, or whether you should have to mow your whole lawn. That was the main thing that was being discussed.
Okay.
I mean, the EC has already said that if you have a naturalized lands, managed naturalized landscape, you don't have to mow. I mean, a managed naturalized landscape would be, you know, natural grasses, natural native flowers, that sort of thing. It would not be grass. That's okay. What it would be. But EC did not feel, I mean, I was the dissenting vote. EC did not feel like it was, it's not environmentally sound to mow grass, at least to use grass, gasoline, and, you know, petrochemical to mow the lawn. So EC felt, in looking at it from an environmental point of view, they didn't want to make a recommendation regarding whether you should mow all your lawn or not. So they're basically handing it back to Planning Commission as it was.
They didn't want to recommend a height. They didn't want to recommend
They also didn't want to make a...
They didn't want to recommend
They didn't want to recommend mowing, That's
Now it's going to go back to Planning Commission
have to decide.
Yeah, with Environmental Commission saying, here are some additional invasives to add to it, but not making any other recommendation.
Okay. Well, I would just like there to be some decision made before we get back into...
It's in Planning Commission's hand.
Okay, right. And so with Planning Commission.
Right.
Have a meeting.
Okay.
We'll discuss it and we will make a decision.
Okay.
Well, we'll make a recommendation to council.
Okay.
Yep, good.
Okay, Judith?
Okay, so starting with the Library Commission committee, there were two main things. I mean, they've been, you know, they follow the little repairs and so on that need to be done, and they're keeping track of all of that. But the Virginia Hamilton historical marker will be installed in front of the flower bed and dedicated on March 22 at 1 p.m. So for people, and it is a plaque, a historic plaque.
It's the historical marker. It's the same thing.
It's a historic marker.
Yeah, I mean, it's the big historical marker.
It's not one of those little things on the ground. But
no,
it's
significant.
Yeah.
Yes.
So that's cool. That'll be really exciting.
May I make an announcement about the library?
Sure. Yeah.
Tomorrow at 1 o'clock, there's going to be a quilt. I guess it will be hung at the library for Faith Patterson.
Oh, awesome.
And so anyone in the community who would like to come to that event at 1 o'clock is welcome to come.
And will it stay,
will
it stay in the library?
I'm not sure.
Yes, I think it is. I think it is.
It's going to stay there. Yeah.
And do we know what time the March 22nd?
It's at 1 o'clock.
Okay.
At 1 o'clock.
And can I hold
yes,
on?
Yes, sure.
Is that all coordinated with staff?
I did not make the Library Commission meeting because I was sick.
Okay.
It's the day after the last council meeting, and nobody got back to me. So I will get with Jason tomorrow
Jason has been to the site. We have discussed it, and it has been discussed that village staff will do the installation and will do the work necessary. And I think that there was some discussion that the Library Association would then do some of the planting in the area. It's going to go in the planting bed that's right by the side of the door, that some of those plants probably have to come out, and that the association would take care of putting them back in again.
Okay, and then the Patty, I'll send you these minutes if you don't have them yet from Connie. Do you have them?
Yes, I have
them. Did you get them?
I didn't.
Okay, so there's some kind of a drainage problem on the north side, just to say. So
over on the north side
on
where
north
the dry well went in, they're saying there's still a drainage problem. Jason's aware.
This building seems to have a lot of little problems. I don't know, but anyway, so that's the Library Commission. They keep excellent track of everything over there, the physical plan of the building. And then the Energy Board, a couple of things. First of all, I wanted to make a motion that we give a $3,000 financing to Xylem for a project they're doing there, and I think you could probably explain it a little bit better. It's a way to get other monies towards energy efficiency.
Well, the, yeah, the lighting that Brian mentioned at the beginning is actually lighting that Xylem was working with Efficiency Smart to put into their facility here to help them reduce their energy costs. And this project was in its beginning stages, and because we canceled our Efficiency Smart program before the project could be completed, that means they don't get their rebate that they were planning on as part of their improvement here for their energy efficiency. So after much consideration and my emailing back and forth with Steve Sumter and a couple other people at Efficiency Smart to determine exactly what would be appropriate, Energy Board settled on recommending a $3,000 rebate to Xylem because this was in process when we canceled our program.
Right. And is that's what they would have received?
That's what they said they would like, from $3,000 to $5,000.
Okay.
As what they had figured. And they said $3,000 was adequate. So I'd like to make a motion that we go ahead and do that for them.
Second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 And then a little glitch we ran into, I think Patty figured this out, is that, you know, we want to replace Efficiency Smart. We're talking with a couple of organizations. Empower is one, and Go Sustainable is another one, around, you know, an energy efficiency program for the village. We thought we had this money to work with, you know, that was paying for Efficiency Smart, but actually once Efficiency Smart went away, that money stopped getting collected, which, you know, means people are paying a little less on their utility bill, but there is no little pot of money. It would actually have to come out of the general fund. So
could it come out of the electric fund?
Or the electric fund. I mean, it would be something we'd have. It's not something that there's a little pot of money there for. Mm-hmm. So, the Energy Board wanted to know kind of, you know, what the commitment of the village was. You know, because we were saying we had this money to spend, and now it's because they're meeting with these two. They met with Go Sustainable. We're going to be meeting with Empower. They kind of work together to put little community programs together around, you know, to help people be more efficient. And, you know, the goal of the Energy Board is to be reaching people who haven't, you know, who are not focused at this, trying to get beyond that. And also they would like to get past to the rental. To, you know, rental properties and landlords, you know, and trying to make some things happen there in terms of. So anyway, they're meeting with, met with one group, they work together, these two groups too. And, you know, it would, so I guess they're, you know, looking at a proposal, as long as council is kind of open to helping finance something, probably not $40,000, but. You know, there was a certain pot of money there put for the commissions, and I can't remember how much it was. Was it $20,000 for everybody? Something like that? $25,000. So
I would consider that separate personally. I mean, say that this should, if that we should be looking at electric fund money to see if we have, if we can allocate money out of the electric fund. And I think only our finance director can tell us that. Maybe that's something she can bring to the next meeting.
What was that? I'm sorry.
If we have funds within the electric department budget that we could invest in an efficiency program, mm-hmm. an energy efficiency program.
Okay. So yeah, if Melissa can determine that, the Energy Board will pursue that. I mean, my sense is these groups can do different things. Some cost more, some cost less. And then the question is some, especially lower income households, if there would want to be any kind of subsidizing of something, that some kind of, you know, I mean, it would have to be some kind of limited number, so on. So we've been kind of talking about those ideas.
And there might be other money available for that. You know, there could be, it's possible that that would be something that the Community Foundation might be willing to put some money into. And there might be state or federal money also available. So,
good point.
You know, if somebody would be doing some grant searching.
Okay. So that's the Energy Board. And then the Justice System Task Force, I'd like to make a motion that we add Reverend Randolph to the Justice System Task Force.
Second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 And then just to say very quickly, Pat's trying to, it's such a huge project. She's trying to find a a way to frame the kind of recommendations. So there's some kind of an organizational structure to it. And so she's been trying to herd the cats of the justice system to Asworth with some difficulty. But it's these, so the framework she is proposing, and I think we're just going to try it, is this thing called the Six Pillars, I think it's called Six Pillars, which came out of the Obama administration's task force on policing. It's focused at policing. It's not focused at the mayor's quarter, you know, the court system. So we thought we would add a seventh pillar. I mean, this was the things we were talking about, which would be the mayor's court and restorative justice would be a seventh pillar. But it's just a way, as proposals come out of the committees, for us to help bring some organization to what, you know, could be a lot of different things. So, and
right.
So that's what's happening there. And I don't think there's anything. And, oh, and then the final thing is we've got all these, we've got several recommendations that, you know, maybe three or four that are ready to come to council. One on the mayor's court, the use of force taser policy. And if council, I mean, this is where, I mean, maybe I should talk with Patty and the chief a little bit, because then there's the question of implementation of some of these. I mean, chief is already moving on some bits of this, so it's, so I think we're all moving in the same direction, and that's a good thing. But, you know, there will be some implementation questions, so maybe I need to.
That was my first thought, as I wondered if you should talk to staff. Yeah. Or you should meet with staff.
Well, the
first
thing about it is, does council want to hear about it once we also know what the implementation policy is, or is that something that's determined after council decides, yes, we should go forward?
Well, I guess I feel like it kind of goes hand in hand, because I'd like to hear from staff about.
Okay.
About how easy or how, you know, how the implementation would happen. I mean, you know, to spend a bunch of time on something and then, you know, to have some kind wrench put in it. So I think you know, it seems like chief is moving forward on so many of the same arenas that it makes sense.
Well, part of the thing is he is, but, you know, part of our idea is that we need policy in place so that if chief leaves 20 years from now or whenever, you know, then, you know, it's a policy. It's not just an individual's, you know, so that it's in place.
I absolutely agree, but, you know, I'd say just do that interim step.
You're saying coordinate.
And then,
okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Sounds good.
Green County Regional Planning Commission, I had an executive committee meeting.
Can I ask this?
Sure.
When you say get with staff, if staff says they can do it, that kind of automatically says council is going to agree with it.
I don't think it's more about implementing. I mean, it's more about just, you know, getting their input.
So we have a full proposal before we bring it. So we have a complete proposal.
And everything needs to be reviewed by legal and all of that.
Right. But when, in other words, are you saying from staff you want their implementation piece to go along with
what we'd bring to council?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so
So Green County Regional Planning Commission, the executive committee met today. I'm actually going to miss the meeting next week. Let's see, they're working on Ken LeBlanc, who's the director, is actually working on. He wants to get some countywide planning done, which is really important. And actually, we talked about certain situations that, you know, would directly impact us. You know, kind of development. What areas, say, county water would serve? Where there are water and sewer facilities available? Looking at all the facility planning areas and all the urban service boundaries, to really provide a planning tool. And in Ken's mind, it's about, you know, kind of really firming up what are areas that are going to be focused on developing and what are areas that we're not going to develop. So I think it's a really important step. Ken's really pushing it, and I appreciate that, because it as we found out at our meeting today, there is pressure. We're going to, I think it's going to continue on us, so we need to be, I want the county to be looking at it in a little bit more, in a little bit broader sense. MVRPC did not have a meeting last month. The chamber, I left, I had, each of you have their, our annual report, the 2016 annual report that reviews what we did in 2016. One thing I do want to talk about, just highlight briefly, is the Bulldog Brigade. It is a group of Jody Chick's students from the high school who we worked with. Jody sent me an email and said, you know, we want to get our students out to start preparing them for the workforce. And then Greene County Department of Disabilities joined in, and they really, these kids went out, they they started out doing deliveries of visitors guides and things for the chamber. Now they're working at Dark Star Books, they're working at Mills Park Hotel. At the annual meeting, they came and did a presentation. At the annual meeting, these kids did a PowerPoint presentation. We got a contact from the Fairborn Holiday Inn. They want to hire some of these kids and get involved in the program. So we're really, awesome. You know, we're really proud. We were the first chamber in the in Greene County to get involved. And then on the back is our new strategic plan. We've kind of fine-tuned our mission. Down at the bottom, you see what we're going to be focusing on in 2017 and 2018, really looking for more community projects to be more involved in supporting the community. So it was a busy month getting ready for that annual meeting. So future agenda items, one thing we did add is, so March 2nd is the community forum about the CBE. We did add an executive session for March 2nd at 5:30. Pardon?
No,
for
March
the purpose,
2nd.
March 2nd at 5:30.
Before
for the purpose
the
of the discussion of the employment.
Meeting,
but that's not a council meeting.
It's, we scheduled, it's going to be an executive session.
Okay.
Well, I guess we'll call a special meeting. We'll call, it's a special meeting of council on March 2nd. 5:30. You don't need to be here, Susan. And then March 2nd is the community forum for the CBE. March 6th is our next meeting. I mean, the we've got special report design 9. We're checking on that. Actually, we'll take off the resolution about council goals. We may very well, the two items on that agenda, if we're able to remove design 9, will be the police, the report on from New Year's Eve. We will have Dave Williamson here. There will be a full release of that report, and then a discussion of with Tecumseh Land Trust potentially about the Arnovitz property. And there will be an executive session before that meeting also at 6 o'clock about to discuss real estate sale. Let's see, so after that March 20th, we've got the easement on the glass farm. We don't have anything for April 3rd at this point. What's the April 24th? Is that the retreat?
Yeah.
Okay. So this kind of shows you, I mean, we really don't have anything, I think, identified yet. Let's put March 20th, we'll put the 2017 goals at March 20th.
When was the Justice System Task Force bringing their recommendations?
Well, they just decided that they're going to talk to.
I thought if we're ready to bring it to the next meeting after.
So March 20th? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So I'm sure that those agendas will fill up pretty quickly. So can I get a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
We made it, Judith.
We did.